So the board will now return to session following our lunch recess, and we will take up item number 5D, presentation and possible action on retiree health plan work group recommendations on the termination and alternatives to the termination of the non-Medicare eligible retiree health plan effective February 29th, 2012. And this is sponsored by the executive office, and we will go to CEO Carmel Angelo.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chair McCallan, members of the board, and members of the public. We'll be proceeding today. This is a staff presentation based on request by the board, direction by the board, actually, to come back within 60 days on the results of a committee that was put together with our human resources, Keenan, our consultant, and with representatives from AMCRE. So I think that certainly today we have a challenging issue in front of us, which is retiree health care. I believe that this issue for this board certainly is as challenging as some of the issues you've dealt with over the past couple years. Under this board's direction, we've looked at a workforce reduction of approximately 30%. We have also asked our employees to take a 10% reduction in salary and benefits, and we have reduced services to the public. All of these actions have been taken not because we have wanted to take these actions, but because we've had to take these actions due to the fiscal condition in this county. The board has asked the staff and the public for understanding and patience as we continue to mitigate a long-standing general fund shortfall. One thing I think that we've learned over the past couple years is that decisions made today can impact future generations in this county, as evidenced by yesterday's decisions around the handling of the TEETER program. And those decisions around TEETER have obligated the county for the next few years. That's what we're dealing with, and that's what we will be dealing with.
As Ms. Angelo, they're saying that they can't hear at the back of the room, a familiar theme today.
Oh, can you hear me better now? We've had this problem throughout the day.
Well, we do also have seats closer to the front, and if people are having trouble hearing, they could move up.
It's better now.
That works.
That works better. It's better.
Okay.
You're better.
Okay, great. So to continue, as your CEO, I hope I never recommend that this board incur unnecessary debt for tomorrow's generations of Mendocino County policymakers, as we are living with these decisions of the past. Today, you are again challenged to make serious decisions that impact the lives of prior employees, the lives of our retirees. Nothing is more serious than access to health care, and in this case, health insurance. As directed by this board, we're in front of you today with the staff recommendation and retiree recommendations that came out of the Retiree Health Care Committee. How we'll move forward today is that we will start with Pat Meek, our Human Resources Director, and Sue Goodrick, our Human Resources Manager. We have Mr. Peter McNamara with us from Keenan, our consultant, who's been working with us on this issue. And then we have members of the retiree work group, and they will be presenting their recommendations, and I believe Mr. Richard Shoemaker will be presenting the recommendations. But before I turn this over to the staff, I'd like to make a comment about the direction of this board and the recommendation from the Chief Executive Office and staff and the consultant today. Back in November, when we came forward to discuss the elimination of the plan, based on the financial status of the plan, we were extremely dependent on excess earnings. As a matter of fact, they covered the plan. We had one payment left. We were not able to get that payment from the retirement board. And so back in November, staff came forward with a recommendation to eliminate the plan. And that is what this board did, which is one of the reasons why we have the committee that is coming forward today with their recommendations. Today, the recommendation from the CEO and staff and the consultant if I was going to look at what is the best course of action for the fiscal stability of this county, I would be sitting before you today saying to continue with this board's direction to eliminate retiree health care. Knowing that this board is serious about looking for other options, just as serious as staff and the retirees have been, the recommendation that's coming from the CEO today is that we continue with offering the plan as is with the premium of $922 a month. And I believe that Ms. Meek and Ms. Goodrick and Mr. McNamara will talk a little bit more about that. There is material in here also that will speak to that $922 a month as well. But I wanted to be clear with this board that if I was going to sit here and say what's the best course of action financially for this county, I would say to continue with the direction of eliminating the plan that would be effective the end of February. Knowing that we have retirees out there that over the past couple months have looked for other health access and haven't been able to find it, our recommendation today is to stay with the 922. Staff, the CEO, and the consultant, we do not support the recommendations of the retirees. And the reasons for that we'll go into with the presentation. So at this point in time, I'm going to turn it over to Pat Meek.
Chair McCowan?
Yes, Supervisor Brown.
I received this in my box. It's marked today's date.
Titled, What Were the Hurdles?
Yes. And I just wanted to make sure each one of my colleagues have picked up their report.
Does everyone have it?
No,
it was put in our box. Okay, well, staff can bring those in for us.
Bring them in.
And then, did you reference the updated attachments?
I'm not certain that I did, but I will. What you received at 12:36 this afternoon, Supervisor Brown spoke to, was a document that was brought in by the retirees. We have not seen this. If there's information in here that this board has questions on, I'm not certain we'll be able to answer them because we don't know the validity of some of the information that's in here. What you did receive from staff this afternoon was a revised retiree recommendations and CEO recommendation, and then the alternative plans. The revision here is around the OPEB liability figures, the initial documents that you received and that the retirees received as well, discussed the OPEB liability, and there were figures under OPEB liability that were a couple hundred thousand dollars. What we learned earlier today, based on a reconfiguration and looking at the numbers a little closer, was that the OPEB liability is actually in the 600,000 range, not the 200,000 range. So it definitely is an impact to the county with that OPEB liability. So
and
I think that staff could speak to that if you'd like as we move forward.
Well, at the appropriate time. And,
yes.
And just for people who are not aware, OPEB is other post-employment benefits.
That's right.
And in this case, it's the retiree health insurance.
That's right.
Okay, thank you. Please proceed.
Okay, Ms. Meek.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and Board. Pat Meek, Human Resources Director. Ms. Angelo gave the background of what transpired to get us here today, so I'm going to start in our report on page 2 and give a brief summary, and then we can move to the retiree recommendation and again discuss the CEO and HR staff and our plan consultant recommendation and then have questions. I wanted to explain that there are three attachments to our report. The attachments number 1 and 2 are the recommendations, and attachment 1 is the retirees' recommendation. Attachment 2 are all of the alternatives that were just explored as part of the work group, and also includes the staff recommendation. The OPEB liability amounts were changed, which means we had to update the chart, which is why we just handed them out. There are copies in the back if anybody wants to pick up a copy so they can see it. We needed to revise the charts because there was a difference of interpretation in terms of blending. So once we discovered that, we had Aon last night basically rerun the numbers. So that's why you've got revised charts. You also have a chart, attachment 3, which shows the rate levels for 2011 and 2012, and also provides an explanation of how rates are determined for the retiree health plan. I also should mention that attachment 1 has explanations of the variety of terms that are used as far as looking at the factors involved in determining rates in terms of what blending means, blending, different rates, separation, credibility, OPEB liability, and stabilization reserve. So back to our report.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Pat, could you clarify what attachment 3 is? It may just be that I have a hole through that part of my page, but is that the one that says active and non-Medicare eligible retiree health plan?
Yes, it's active and non-Medicare eligible retiree health plans, and it's the participants and the rates for 2011 and 2012.
So that's one, and
then we just handed you revised attachments 1 and 2.
We have a new 2. Okay, so we have a new 1 and 2, and
yes,
then we've got 3. Okay, gotcha.
Okay. So I'm on page 2 of the report, current status. We wanted to give you an update on the current status and why the health plan rates for the retiree pool remained at 922, even though the enrollees dropped by about half. Initially, when we presented in September and talked about the increased rate and that impact on the retirees, Keenan and Associates had indicated to us that if the plan enrollment dropped by 10% or more, then we would have to look at the rates again. It turns out, because the pool is so small and the credibility factor is zero, that whether the pool has 120 or 60, the rates can remain the same. And that was Keenan's evaluation after we conducted our open enrollment. So our current enrollment for the retiree health plan right now is 52 retirees with 9 dependents for a total of 61. We wanted to also give you future enrollment levels so that you could think about what the impacts might be for 2012 and 2013. According to Aon, who conducted our actuarial analysis for the OPEB liability, they are estimating out of the total active employees, current employees, who would be eligible to retire in 2012 and 2013, that there would be 292, and out of that group, approximately 63 would be expected to enroll in the plan. Also during year 2012 and 2013, we would have 22 retirees who would turn 65, therefore would no longer be eligible for the plan. So we're talking about 41 possible enrollees. So when we talk about 2012 and 2013, we're talking generally about 100 to 120 people, which again, because of credibility factors, isn't much of an impact when you look at rates. So I wanted you to have that information as we engage in this conversation. At this point, we were going to have Sue give a funding status update.
Good afternoon. I wanted to briefly discuss our most recent figures on the funding. As the report indicates, the auditor's office showed a deficit of $386,000 in the Retiree Health Trust Fund. However, that did not include the ERP money, the Early Retiree Reinsurance Program money that we have collected, which is a total of $402,000 thus far. Keenan has performed an audit based on federal requirements that have basically tightened up the restrictions on what qualifies for these funds. And this occurred after we had already received about $334,000. And it turns out that we're going to have to return approximately $137,000 of the money we've collected thus far. So with that being said, and we're firming up those numbers, we have Keenan's attorneys currently investigating if there's anything further that might disqualify us for any of those funds, but it looks pretty close like we're going to be able to retain the difference, which is $265,000. In addition, we have applied for another $151,000, which if we were and it has been accepted, the application for those funds has been accepted by the feds, but we have not yet heard whether or not they're going to fund them. And, but if they should do so, we only qualify for those funds if we still have a plan in place at the time of the receipt of those funds. So with the plan ending in February, if the funds became available to us in March, we would have to return them. So so that 151 could potentially be, you know, an offset if we should, your board should decide to move forward with this plan. In addition to that, there is some current legislation where there's a possibility that they're going to extend the ERP program, and we're pretty confident that will happen. We're not the only county.
Well, we have a question from Supervisor Hamburg. Yeah.
Excuse me, Sue, I just wanted to ask you that 151 in ERP funds, am I correct in thinking that would be counted against the 293 or the 219, or is that over? You know,
no, that would actually be, that's in addition to. That would be additional money.
I don't understand that because
The $265,000 yeah. would be the offset to the $386,000 deficit.
Right.
Okay, and the difference between that
is 121.
Is 121,
right.
With the possibility of the additional 151.
Okay.
However, there's a number.
So that would put us $30,000 in the black, and then there are some funds that we may have to return. Is that correct?
We've already taken
those
into account.
That into account. Okay, so instead of being 121 in the hole, we're 30 in the black.
Sort
of. If we get the 151.
Yeah, if you got the 151, but also there's still a number of expenses that we've already incurred that we have not seen yet. For okay. example, the this recent Aon OPEB analysis, you know, we're estimating around $10,000. We haven't been billed for that. The wellness program component that some of our retirees are participating in, that's about $2,500 that hasn't been billed here. And then there's also another $25,000 for the GADSB 34 report. So there's a number of expenses out there that have not accounted for. So
okay.
right now we're looking at sort of breaking even without the 151. And when I say breaking even, that is as the end of December.
But is it safe to say that we do not anticipate ERP funding that would offset the county subsidy that we see on these charts? Do you know which county I'm talking about?
With regard to the amounts on attachment one?
Yes, I'm looking at attachment one. I mean, you talked about the possibility of future ERP funding should we maintain this program. And what I'm trying to understand is whether that ERP funding would offset any of the county paid subsidy for non-Medicare retiree health care.
No.
Okay. That's what I was.
And at some point, maybe we'll get an explanation of why it can't be an offset.
It's already been taken into account for the 922 rates, is why.
For the 922 rates, but also the calculation of the OPEB liability?
No, the OPEB has not been accounted for. It's separate. Absolutely separate, yes.
Okay, we can go on.
The reason that it's not counted, the OPEB liability is the implicit subsidy. It's the amount that would the active plan would be subsidizing the retirees. The early retiree reimbursement money is specific to those who are between the early retiree ages of, I forget the lowest age, but before age 65. So you have to be a retiree, have incurred a claim above $15,000, but below $90,000, and then the feds are reimbursing 80% of that difference. So it has to be a retiree, cannot be used
in a blended plan.
Right.
Any further questions? Okay.
Yes, thank you, Sue.
Then the one other thing I wanted to note was the county's liability for $105,000, which had to do with your Medicare eligibles and the payment of the last 3 months' worth of funding to their HRAs. That has been set aside, or the liability has been set aside in a separate account and has not been accounted for here. So that is an additional county liability, which the executive office is going to be bringing to your attention with recommendations at mid-year budget review.
And that will be separate and by itself, regardless of what alternative the board chooses here.
That's correct. So if you had no further questions, I'd pass it back to Pat.
If I can make one comment, that $105,000 for the Medicare eligibles, that is a general fund cost, an
correct.
Unanticipated general fund cost today, outside of anything, any costs that are incurred with our non-Medicare eligibles.
So.
Okay, I wanted to give you a little explanation of the Retiree Health Plan Work Group. The group consisted of HR staff. I facilitated. Sue Goodrick was a member, and Peter McNamara attended all four meetings. And our retiree representatives were Sue Thornhill, Marcia Wharf, Richard Shoemaker, and Carol Nordhorst. We met four times. The meetings were open to the public, and the attendance was typically between 30 to 35 retirees. In addition to our four meetings with the work group representatives met with the CEO and Human Resources last week to discuss the proposed recommendation. The work group discussed and reviewed a variety of health plan premium rate scenarios, an actuarial report on OPEB liability prepared by Aon Consulting, and we looked at plan deficit projections and catastrophic plan proposals with a range of deductibles that was prepared by Keenan and Associates. We also, in Human Resources, maintained an email list and built a quite a lengthy email list of 60 or so retirees so that we were able to keep everyone informed of meeting dates, times, agendas, and meeting materials. So at this point, our CEO, Angelo, has reviewed and mentioned the staff recommendation, and we can go into that in the details and how we got there, but we also wanted the retiree representatives to be able to present their recommendation, which is on attachment one. So Richard Shoemaker is the retiree spokesperson. Richard.
This working? Can you hear
yeah.
it in the back? Okay, great. So you did receive a document from us today, and I will say that I wanted to have it prepared in a manner that would be like one page, but obviously there's seven, and there's quite a bit of material on it. Let me start off by saying what happened today with a piece of paper with a new OPEB liability on it is typically how the whole process has moved along. And I don't mean that in any negative sense of the word. There's been a moving target on a lot of this. I just heard something stated earlier. I hadn't heard it stated before, and that was in regard to the IRP money, in regard to blended plans or non-blended plans. That's a surprise at this point, and we should look at that more. So the retirees appreciate the opportunity to work in this group and try to kind of save our behinds in regard to our health care plans. We'd like to acknowledge the county staff and the consultant for the work they did with us. The meetings that we did have as a group were 3 and 4 hour meetings. A lot of work was done. I'd like to personally thank and acknowledge the diligent work of Carol Mordhorse, Sue Thornhill, and Marcia Wharf, which brought a lot of analysis and historical perspective to the work. They've been around this issue for a long time, and I believe they contributed an unbelievable amount to where we got to. So, you know, why are we here? The good old death spiral. We're in it. On the 15th of November, you said kill the death spiral. And obviously that's not an acceptable outcome to a lot of folks, so this group went to work. If you want, I'll go into this document now, and basically I'm going to go through and read, and you can read along with me. It's going to take a few minutes. I'm going to stop at each kind of section where there's bullet points and see if you have questions or comments, And I would welcome those same questions or comments from the staff as we go through them. Has everybody been furnished a copy of this? Okay. I was asked to bring it here to be given to the board for their lunchtime reading, but I guess it didn't make it there, so we will see it for the first time right now.
Well, we had a late lunch also, but it'll be up to you, I suppose, but if you could avoid reading every word and kind of summarize what you're presenting, and then, of course, it's the bullet points that you're looking for reactions or questions primarily. Is that correct?
To some degree. And then we
but you want to give us the background first. So anyway, yeah. Please proceed. If you can paraphrase rather than read, we would probably accept that. But
I'll
it'll be up
best.
To you.
So obviously we use the Mercer report as our takeoff point. You can see the items listed as hurdles to blending the retirees with the current employees. The group worked to create a structure that would, I'm going to go to the meet and confer section. We met and worked to create a structure that we believe would not require meet and confer. You see an alternative B on attachment one. In that alternative, the retirees were going to pick up the cost of the blending program that would normally be put in the hands of your employees. That was an effort to cover that. We were told at the meeting on Wednesday that every proposal we have on the board is now a meet and confer proposal. So with that in mind, and obviously you'll get different interpretation about what meet and confer is. If the county wants to do meet and confer on these issues, it's probably a good thing to do for good positive labor relations. But it's not as onerous as we continue to hear. Meet and confer in regard to this issue is a letter to the represented groups explaining in a minor way what you want to do and asking them if they want to talk to you about it. You have a meeting, you talk to them. Worst case scenario, some of them jump up and down and say, over my dead body.
Maybe it'd be better if you just read it.
Okay, well, John, I'm just trying to do your wishes.
Well, in a nutshell, though, I think you're saying that as long as the action does not change, represents no change to the labor agreements, working conditions, or benefits, you're saying meet and confer might be a good idea, but it's not required.
Well,
but
no,
opinions may vary on that.
What I'm really saying is, let's send the letter. Let's have the discussion. We believe there'll be support and no opposition. I ask that you involve us in maybe the more difficult meetings. We have certainly already made contact and identified employee groups that might have something to say. Bottom line, we don't think it's as onerous. John, I'm not going to respond well to be hurried along.
What I'm saying is just I sidetracked you with a question.
Okay.
So if you would go forward and again, maybe just reading it because you put a lot of thought into how you put
yeah.
it together.
Well, and I guess I'll make the comment about this whole program. The serious things that Ms. Angelo said you've done this year with employees' wages and cuts and services, they're dead serious. This is dead serious, and the word dead is literal in some cases on this issue. So I think rushing through it is not necessarily the best way to go with it.
Well, you're sitting at the table, so I don't see how you can say you're being rushed through it. But instead of debating it, why don't you just make the presentation you want to make?
Great, thank you. So, meet and confer, we've covered it. One of the issues with accounting for utilization of the Active Employee Stabilization Fund. To make it short, the rates created by the consultant included payments into the stabilization fund by retirees. Retirees, when they're employees, paid into the stabilization fund. So when they become retirees, they still have money in that fund, and they'll pay more when they're retirees. There is also a portion of a payback amount of about $113,000 in our rate that once it is paid back will be another large contribution to the stabilization fund that you could argue should be taken out of that rate and given back to us. Stabilization fund, we're paying in.
And Before you go further, I would like to ask our staff and consultants to be taking notes, and so that when we get to questions, if there's things they agree with or disagree with, we can identify those clearly.
Great.
So please proceed.
I welcome that. The plan designed to be considered. Obviously, we looked at a number of plans, and the plan we picked out is the same plan we currently have. It's the same plan as your current employees have. You can see that on the attachments. OPEB liability. This is the wild card in all of this. I mean, you guys had $129 million of OPEB liability not long ago. You took an action against your retirees in regard to funding retiree health care plans that made it zero. That was a great move in regard to bond ratings and so forth. Did a lot of work looking at OPEB liability around the country and looked at a lot of good studies in a number of states. OPEB liabilities of significance are approximately equal to the annual budget amount of the agency. The fact we may create a $600,000 OPEB liability in the onerousness of OPEB liabilities is, I will say, peanuts. This, your consultant has said, will go away in 2 years. It won't be carried on your books for 30. And so I think that the OPEB liability issue is one that can be debated endlessly as to the actual impact. Now, if your bonding rating companies take that $600,000 and make that an issue in bonding, what are they going to do with your $130 million of real debt? So, kind of keep a focus on what that OPEB really will become as a component for any issues you have around borrowing. You know, again, an ongoing discussion, but we think it's been reduced to an insignificant or minimal amount. If you go on, we have the development of rates and any direct subsidies inherent within the rates. That's simply stated in the attachments you've gotten. We've requested a $293,000 cost to the county for this Alternative One program. So you get to the section of cost to the county. Now, I heard Mr. Supervisor Hamburg's questions about the 150 and applying it against the 293 and so forth. And this may be very well where that question came from, and I'm going to kind of zero in on this one a little bit. We've done our best to try to keep the cost down to the county. But to have a plan that takes advantage of all the issues that you can take advantage of, there needs to be some cost to the county. With the county contributive to an active retiree plan that it can continue to apply for IRP funds from the federal government. You currently have a $150,000, $151,000 claim that would not likely be funded by the feds without an active plan. I think you just heard that. Your consultant has included it in the retiree rate calculations, the current shortfall in the retiree plan of $113,000. That shortfall, if you have no plan, will be your problem. In the plans, it's the retiree's problem who's paid out of their rate. Now, they're also in the blended plan includes a $42 a month dental and vision benefit that retirees will not be participating in. That's a contribution back to the plan by retirees of $37,400 a year. So there's another payment into the plan above regular payments that retirees are going to make. If you take that 151, if you take the 113, and you take that 37, that adds up to almost $300,000 that you could, I'll call it, credit against the $293,000 cost to the county. Now, why do I say you can credit against it? Because you can't get the 151 unless you have a plan. I realize that's a reimbursement, but that's money you'll never see if you don't have a plan. So you could generally give it some credit. The other numbers will go directly into the costs of the plan that will actually reduce that $293,000.
So you're saying the three bullets at the bottom of page three, in effect, would represent a credit of $300,000 to the county if we go forward with the plan.
Yeah, particularly we're saying the blended plan. Now, and again, I'll admit that 151 is a reimbursement. But, you know, if you can't get it without a plan, you can't get it. Okay, the next page, you've spent $163,000 for 12 months of reinsurance. If you end the plan on March 1, you've still spent $163,000, if I'm not correct. That's what I heard the other day. And in the rate that you'll collect from us is a payment for that $163,000 12-month reinsurance plan. No collection of that rate, no payment toward the plan. These next items are not actually dollar items, but the policy items, attitude items. If you accept the $293,000 cost, you might lessen the concerns of the retirement administrator that led to the eventual action of the retirement board holding your $658,000 retiree health trust money. If you look at the March 10th or March 2010 minutes, you'll see that discussion. It also appears without a plan in place, the county share and the county sharing some of the expense, the retirement board will continue to question the legality of turning the withheld retiree benefit trust funds over to the county. A blended plan has the ability to keep county costs stable. Wild swings may result from the current plan staying in effect with an insufficient size pool of enrollees. Another potential savings to the county is in reduced administrative expenses. Will it be major? Probably not. But you'll no longer need two different studies, two different enrollments, two different management areas, two projections. We do understand that most of this stuff is administered on a per person basis, but there are costs that are duplicated having two different plans. There are other numerous financial things that we'll talk about later in the document. The next section I've got here is hurdles addressed. What we've just gone through very quickly, and I'm sure it hasn't sunk in entirely, is the hurdles listed in the Mercer report have been addressed. I believe if you sit down with a serious discussion of those same things, they are not as onerous as they may seem and would require a little bit of work to get through them. So that would take us to the CEO's recommended action. We looked at this and we agree that this is a good recommendation for the Board of Supervisors.
Supervisor Hamburg has a question.
Yeah, just before we get to the last page, I think you're just starting on page 5, right?
Right.
Right. Just going back to that decision by the retirement board to withhold the 658, what are the concerns specifically that are going to be lessened by the county accepting this 293, which is a 293 per year, by the way, right?
Correct.
Yeah. Just wanted everybody to be clear that we're talking about.
Correct.
And we're talking about the potential of a 2-year commitment, right? So it's 293 times two or 219 times two, depending on which one of those blended alternatives we might choose.
That's correct.
But could you just clarify that third bullet down on page 4?
When doing some research on this during this past week, I came across minutes from a retirement board meeting where the retirement board was discussing the county's action to rescind the resolution that had you paying 50% of any shortfalls from excess earnings that would go into the retiree trust fund. Mm-hmm. And it said, and I hate to say I have it here, but it's in a pile of paper and I won't take the time. Mm-hmm. The simple version was that started the conversation of, well, you know, is this money going to be legally passed to the retiree trust fund in the county of Mendocino? I can't give it any more than that. You'd have to review the minutes yourself. Carol Mordhorst was at the meeting. Janine was at the meeting. But again, it's just something I came across that look like somebody was waving a flag because you stopped subsidizing the plan.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so the recommended action, you know, we believe that last action on the 15th, it was kind of surprising actually to most people in the room that that occurred. We thought we were here to talk about forming this committee, but at the same moment, suddenly we were told 90 days from then, there would be no plan. And that action actually, I think, has surprised everybody and has left a lot of uncertainty in a lot of minds, both fiscally, legally, and so forth. What we do know is that action will guarantee you'll never see the $658,000 the retirement board continues to hold, but say you might get it, and you would never see the IRP money. So if you go, we're going to go down through the bullet points on this page. The recommendation to continue the current retiree health plan in its current form does offer some hope to a limited number of retirees and their spouses. The serious downside of that current plan is retirees need to have significant retirement incomes to afford the costly new premiums. This plan fails in a number of other ways. It does not address the affordability issue for folks on very limited incomes who will not be able to find coverage due to pre-existing conditions. For most Mendocino County retirees, a new premium could cost them at least 50% of their monthly pension, if not all of it in many cases. And that's based on statistics that I pulled out of the retirement board, that the $24,000 a year average pension in this county is held by about 500 people in this category of pre-Medicare, and 360 of them are below 24,000. So three quarters of the people we're talking about here, it would take half their pension money to buy the 922 plan, and if you look down farther, some of them couldn't do it at all because it would take all their pension money. If you add in copays and deductibles, you can imagine the fiscal impact of these people. Most of them are unlikely to be able to work to supplement their income to cover the higher costs. Remember, we're talking about people who've reached the end of their working lives and now live on incomes that are, in many instances, barely sufficient to pay housing, food, transportation, and their current medical costs. Many retirees have been declared disabled by the county, and they need coverage because they can't get on other insurance because they are disabled. And because the county is not intending to make any payments to the plan, the door is closed further on IRP payments from the Federal Reserve Fund, or Federal Health Care Fund. In the end, this plan is not sustainable. It's obvious by the attrition rate over the past 3 years. It's gone from 720 people to 300 people to 120 people, and right now there might be 50 or 60. The people that need this insurance need to be part of a bigger pool. So let's look at the retiree plan work group recommendation. Due to pre-existing conditions of at least 60 retirees that cannot get health insurance, this would offer them a security of health coverage until they reach Medicare age, or at least until the federal health care reform really kicks in. Our key points for this plan is the blended retiree plan will no longer face a death spiral. The county can better manage its health plan cost with one plan. 74 people are added to a pool, and it's not even going to be 74 probably, but they're added to a pool of over 1,600 people. That's only an increase of 4% in enrollees. You will have fulfilled the promises to and expectations of some of your longest-term dedicated employees, many of whom have made very serious in life and career decisions based on the promise of health insurance in retirement. This plan is not free, but it's 33% less expensive than the program you voted to end in November and now are doing a recommendation to keep. The alternate A plan has the retirees paying a substantial portion of the cost for the plan. The county can continue to participate in IRP. The cost is important for the retirees who can no longer work to supplement their retirement. It's nearly the same as the premium they just stopped paying for this past year of $530. It's a serious compromise from the promises that the County of Mendocino made to employees that they would have health insurance furnished in retirement by their employer. Our recommendation also deals with the expectations of 293, that's nearly 30% of the current employees of the County of Mendocino, that are eligible by the rules, the policies, the manuals, and the other documents talking about retiree health plans. Alternative A is a serious compromise. I think you heard a couple minutes ago they're expecting, was it 50 or 60 retirements during the period that we're talking about? So they might want to retire. So there's 293 people eligible, but the, over the year, next year or so, you might get that many more that come in. I have a last section here of something that nobody's looked at, and it's called calculating the cost of keeping the current plan or discontinuing it. Let me stop there. Are there any questions on what I just ran through quickly?
Well, I got a question. It says you are added to a pool of over 1,600. How do you come up with a pool of 1,600?
Well, if you look at chart number three, attachment number three gives you a column of the numbers of enrollees. And now enrollees are employees. So if you look under plan one, where it says total 107, that's 107 employees. If you look at plan two and the total says 598, that's 598 employees. You add them together, it's about 1,000. But if you look at the rows, it says retiree and spouse 24. Well, that number really is 48. If you see employee and child or children, that number is really 2 or 3 or 4. And if you go employee and family, it means employee, spouse, and children or child, and could be 3, 4, 5, or 6. We could never quite get the number of lives that were being insured by the County of Mendocino, but if you go through and do some conservative calculations, I think 1,600 is a pretty solid number. Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Thank you. And it goes to our column. I'd like to point that out. It's our column over there says 93 and 92 for 115. That actually is 93 with one person insured, 20 and 22 with two people insured, for a total of 137, not 115. So you can see how you have to follow through on these to get really how many people are being insured. All right, calculating the cost of keeping the current plan or discontinue it. What I've got listed here are a number of items that if you look at them carefully, if you calculate them out, some of them can only be discussed and debated. Some of them can be calculated. That a blended plan can save money in other areas. If you look at the first one, you have people that are 57 and a half years old. There's 293 of them. They look at having no retiree health benefit plan, so they work for the county till they're 65, till they get Medicare. Every one of them increases their pension cost to you by 19% at a minimum by doing that. If you look at the health plan they're part of, that's the same people that retired at 57 and a half, they're just still working. They're going to utilize that plan at pretty much the same rate, but you're paying 75% of all the costs, and when they retire under our program, you're only going to pay 30% of the costs. So if you had them retire, you'd save money on the health insurance. If you have fewer retirements, it will decrease the county's ability to make new hires in what you will be implementing in lower cost pension tiers. You got to have open jobs to bring these people in at the lower levels of pension benefits. Payroll costs will increase due to longevity pay and regular increases, higher county costs and loss of productivity for employees who have accrued larger vacation allowances, higher county costs and loss of productivity due to missed work because of older worker health-related absences. You'll have a higher cost of sick pay. The potential for worker compensation claims due to older workers being less physically fit to perform some tasks, such as the transportation department, general services, and garage. ditch diggers at 65. Let them retire at 57 and a half. The general lack of productivity to the malaise created by an employer who appears to be not able to be trusted to fill their obligations to current employees and past employees. That's not measurable, but it's there. So some of those things have significant dollar amounts that I think if you wanted to do this plan, the blended plan, that you could go through and figure out that it actually is not as expensive. I spoke to Supervisor McCowan about this, about the $293,000 cost as a truth in packaging number. That's the high end. You add in the credits, you add in the things that you can count here, and it can be reduced. We thank you for listening. I'm sorry it was so long, and glad to answer any questions further in this discussion about our recommended alternative A retiree health plan.
Questions of Mr. Shoemaker at this time? Supervisor Hamburg?
Richard, would you clarify again the group of 293 people who are current employees that are eligible to retire?
But not yet 65.
But are not yet 65. So how did we come up with that number?
Your personnel department, your payroll department, determined all the folks hired before the September 98 deadline for being told
so that's what that retiree, that's what that group benefit. Is. It's yeah. a pre-98.
That's the pre-98 month number.
Okay.
However, those 293 may not necessarily qualify for retiree health right now. Some of those people may not necessarily be 50 and have 10 years of service. Well, they would all have 10 years of service. But yeah. They're not necessarily 50. So that 293 are qualifying, but not today. They couldn't all leave today.
Okay.
Yeah. That's a great.
And out of that.
Although perhaps quite a number of them do qualify currently.
Well, and out of that number, Aon estimated 63 would take advantage of a health plan if there was one. Mm-hmm. So part of our actuarial study looked at the potential retirees in 2012 and 2013 and then applied their formula and said, okay, we're going to look at 63 potential future retirees for 2012 and 2013 mm-hmm. who would participate in the health plan if there were one.
So is what you're saying, Pat, 63 out of those 293 are anticipated to join this blended program if it exists over the next 2 years?
Join a health plan
join
if
a,
it exists.
Join a health plan over the next 2 years.
Or within the next year, you're thinking, aren't you?
Well, we...
Or 2 years, okay.
We went with 2012 and 2013.
Okay. But that still leaves 230 people...
Right,
based on action. Presumably would fit into the new post-2014 healthcare scheme?
Well, I think part of Aon's actuarial study looked at retirement trends. I mean, some of those 292 people may not retire, or they may have alternate health plans, maybe a spouse, or there's something else that they right. could take advantage of. So based on their actuarial right. formulas, they came up with a calculation of 63 would right. likely take advantage of a health yeah. retiree health plan if we had one in 2012 and 2013.
Right.
Additional questions for Mr. Shoemaker at this time? Additional questions for staff at this time?
Could I comment on the 293, when we're commenting on the 293?
Certainly.
One of the issues that's important is not all of them would likely end up on this health plan with the changes we're seeing in health care. But every one of those persons has probably made some sort of life and career decisions because they thought they had a benefit coming to them. And I think that's one of the things we just can't forget in all this. If people like Dave Bingston stayed in Mendocino County when he had opportunities elsewhere.
So does staff have any comments to the information presented by Mr. Shoemaker? Specifically, are there areas of disagreement?
Yes, I'd like to go through the document and we can respond if that works for you. And I know that Peter has been taking notes as well as Sue, so it's because this is the first time we've seen it, bear with us as we go through it, but there are a few items we'd like to address. I'd like to start with meet and confer, and I'd like to ask Janine Nadel to make a comment as our county counsel.
Yeah, it would be my opinion that any changes would require a meet and confer with all of the bargaining units.
Well, specifically, the changes referenced in Alternative A.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Alternative A and B.
And then to meet and confer, if a letter were sent to the employee bargaining units requesting meet and confer, how long would they have to respond to that letter indicating whether they wanted to meet and confer? Because presumably, they could indicate, we don't need to meet on that, we have no issue with it.
Oh, I would give them a reasonable time, no less than 30 days.
Uh-huh. Thank you. Supervisor Brown.
Okay, on A, that's the fully blended. On B, that would also apply for meet and confer. Okay.
Yes. Okay. Please. I think we wanted to comment on bullet number one on page two. Peter? Okay, so I'm going to have Peter comment on that.
It's on. Is it on? Okay. The stabilization that was, that you currently have is a stabilization fund that is specific to the active plan, both plan one and plan two. There is no stabilization reserve for the retiree plan two. The 922 in bullet two, that does include an amount to cover the deficit in the plan that was in place as of 12/31/2011. So the 922 includes recouping the deficit for the retiree plan from the last plan year, not something for the future, but covering what you already have.
Mr. Shoemaker, would you like a little additional clarification on that?
During the work group, the basis for the rate is the 556 that your current employees pay on attachment three. And when we took the retirees and put them together with the actives, that 556 became the baseline amount of money to get to the amount of money needed to fund the whole thing. So if the retirees are paying the 556 with a portion of it is the reserve money, say it's $5, say it's $10, they're paying that money. It's in the 556, they have to pay, and then they have to put their money on top of. That is the premise in bullet point one, and we did discuss it at the work group.
That is correct. So any rate, if you blended the rates, there is an amount in the rate that includes increasing, or let me rephrase it, to ensure that you do not decrease the current reserve fund. So we want to make sure that there's a 3-month stabilization reserve. So the rates include a dollar amount. I don't remember off the top of my head, but say $5 on that rate.
Well, there's agreement that the retirees would be paying to maintain that stabilization rate.
Correct. That would be part of any rate that was developed. My only point was that the 922 is not meant to cover that. The amount in the 922 for the reserve was to fund the deficit that you incurred, not any stabilization.
We agree with that.
Okay. Next point, please.
Sue and Peter, stop me, but if there's something before this, but I'm going to page three, the last bullet, which is the blended plan premium includes $42 per month for dental and vision benefits, and I'm going to ask Peter to also explain that.
So the current rates, and if you do you have the number three so I can have it in front of me as I'm talking? Thank you. So right now, the 556, 38, that number includes, for actives in plan two, includes a dental benefit and a vision benefit. These rates are funding levels. So you're taking the whole cost of those plans and putting them together. It's not appropriate to say, however, that that should be taken out. And I'll use an example that was raised at the last retiree meeting. One of the folks at the meeting said, well, plan two has well baby and other benefits in it that we don't use. Take them out and it will cost less. Well, no, it won't. I mean, the plan design, the dollar amount is based on the overall plan design. The plan design for the active plan two is what it is. It includes a dental benefit, it includes a vision benefit. The plan design for the retirees does not.
However, if you blended it, I think the Mr. Shoemaker's point is the retirees would not be eligible for the dental and vision benefit. So in a blended plan, would that be accounted for and perhaps reduce the overall premium?
No.
And because?
It would not, for a number of reasons, but the largest is the size of this group that we're looking at, which was referred to. It just, from an underwriting perspective, it's not gonna have any impact.
And Mr. Shoemaker has a comment.
Yeah, and if you look at that bullet point, what we're saying is because we don't utilize that part of the plan, we are making an extra contribution of $37,000 a year to the plan.
And that might be true, but what I hear being said is that will not reduce the county cost.
That's correct.
But let's say we're, in that narrow sense, we are subsidizing the county's cost or the active retirees in that narrow, very narrow vision and dental $42. All it is a place where if we were actuarially counted without that benefit, and again, we're, you know, this is playing with pooling. You don't do that in pooling.
Well, let's see how close we can get.
So I would respectfully disagree, and here's why. When you pool it together, we're saying in some of the analysis we did, it's gonna cost $12 million per year to cover the benefits under a blended scenario. This group in plan one gets this benefit that's part of the 12 million. This group that's currently plan two gets this benefit, part of the 12 million. This group that's plan two retires, they get this benefit, part of the 12 million. We're putting them all together, still 12 million. We're not subsidizing, you know, does that mean that the folks who are in option one are subsidizing folks who are using more, you know, the preventative care? I mean, when you start to cull out each individual benefit, well, you don't have a plan. You should just say, you know what, we're gonna write your check every time you go to the doctor.
So if I understand, in effect, you're saying that the retirees would not be getting the dental and vision, but that doesn't make them any different than this other group that would be paying the overall rate, but they would not be getting certain benefits. This group would not be getting certain benefits.
Correct.
So
it's still gonna cost you the same dollar amount.
Right, but these other groups, although they might not use the wellness benefits, would they be eligible to use it if they wanted to?
Yes.
So then I think there's a little distinction there.
Yeah.
And maybe with that we can move on.
Okay, so where are we? I think we wanted to talk a little bit about page 5, second bullet up. Is there anything else, Sue, that you had? So it was about the earth.
And before we get to that, Supervisor Pinches has a comment.
I just have I guess it's a comment or a request. First of all, is there anybody out there that understands all these charts and everything?
We've got some people
everything.
Who think they do.
Well, I'm still with the majority here because I don't. It's pretty easy to understand, but I just, it's a lot to comprehend. I know what I'm interested in, and I don't, I assume I'm kind of in, maybe speaking for
well,
at least the majority. But I mean, we need to kind of, I mean, I want to know what it's going to cost to keep these people in the system and get them some health coverage. I'm not interested in kicking them off the boat. And so I'd like to kind of cut to the chase and see what our annual cost options are for the county.
Well, I think
and
we
let's
should.
See, you know, I mean, to me, this is a lot of this is kind of a charade. Let's get down to the bottom line.
Well, with all due respect, I think we need to go through the process, and I think we're getting close to the point where we'll have the discussion at the board level, and we'll get those specific
My point is, we've had a lot of staff go over this for the last couple of months, and we've had this committee, and it really comes down to what's this board interested in doing for its retirees.
Exactly, but I think we should get the information out there as fully as we can, then we'll get it to the board level, and we'll start with you, so.
Okay, we have one last comment on the document prepared by the retirees. It's page 5, the second bullet up, and it's relating to ERP payments, and again, Peter will respond.
The ERP payments have nothing to do with whether or not the county's funding anything. The payments specifically refer to claims by early retirees that are in excess of $15,000 and below $90,000. It has absolutely nothing to do with who's paying what, and as long as the plan is in place, as Sue mentioned, and the dollars come in while the plan is in place, then you can use them. So in her example, if the $151,000 that was applied for and approved for processing comes in next week and you apply it to the current retiree plan, you've used the $151,000, because those dollars were dollars that were to be reimbursed from the 2011 plan year. Anything after December 31st, 2011 is ineligible for reimbursement, because the plan ends December 31st, 2011, unless extended.
Mr. Shoemaker has a comment.
And that is our point, that you should choose the blended plan. If you choose the current plan that the county puts no money in, it cannot apply for reimbursement because it didn't spend anything. But if it spends that 293, you can apply under the thing he said between this number and that number for reimbursement funds, which has currently brought you $400,000.
And we'll have a response.
So based on the federal guidelines, Richard, that is incorrect. It matters not who pays for the plan. It is the plan, which the county is the plan sponsor. The plan sponsor has a right to apply for early retiree reimbursement funds, assuming that they meet all of the criteria, which in most cases you have, with the exception of the 137 that's going back. And it specifically refers to claims incurred. It doesn't matter at all who paid the claim. It is the plan.
Okay. Sue Goodrich?
I think I might be able to clarify a little bit. Yeah. Part of the problem that we had during the committee time is we were still determining whether or not the county qualified at all, and it had to do with the contribution level at the time of the application. Since then, we've had the attorneys looking at it, and what we charged our retirees was based on a budgetary plan cost estimate. What actually was spent was above and beyond that, and we've had the analysis performed by Keenan's actuarial. So the difference between what we were collecting versus what the cost of the plan actually was, that in essence was the county contribution. And we only had to maintain that contribution for the period, you know, going forward from the period that we applied. And so that is, so we're being told by Keenan that yes, we still do qualify, and we will continue to qualify going forward with our 922 rate.
Right.
But, you know, in Richard's defense,
even if we're not contributing anything, as long as we continue with the 922, as long as we continue with the CEO's recommendation, we continue to qualify for ERP.
Right, because what the intent is any additional ERP money will be used to offset, you know, the cost of the plan, so that would keep it down, hopefully, at the 922 or lower.
We would also qualify for reimbursement with retiree option A as well.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. So, yes. Supervisor Hamburg, that is only, you are correct, to the up to December 31st, 2011. Senator Kerry has introduced legislation to extend the early retiree reimbursement program for another 2 years.
Okay.
So that it will get everyone to the time when the exchange programs actually kick in. It's working its way through Congress now. It's expected to pass. It may not, and that would be for another $5 billion. The rules for that could change, but as it stands right now, the money you're expecting is as long as there's a plan in place when you get the money, right, you can use it.
And Sue Meek, and then Mr. Shoemaker.
Pat, but that's okay.
Okay.
I'm
sorry.
I was going to ask what the board prefers. We can review the staff recommendation and go over the charts, and if that's what you'd like to do, we can start that.
Yeah.
Well, let's have a comment from Mr. Shoemaker first.
Well, you moved off it. The issue that was just raised, Sue started to say, my information was correct to the point that we were just informed a new determination has been made. And for me, that's a qualifying question. If the current plan's in place and it's fully funded by the enrollees, that is still qualified to apply to the federal program for reimbursement.
They're blended.
If the fully, no. If you stayed with the current plan and there was no county subsidy, as we use in this, is it still qualified for federal reimbursement funds? Okay, if Kerry's bill passes, let's try that.
Forward, yes.
Yeah, okay, thanks. And this was asked, I'll ask it again, somebody didn't hear it. The blended plan qualifies as well.
And then HR Director Meek, you have a rather brief summation of the recommended action. So if you'll go to that,
sure,
then we'll see if there's any questions from the board for clarification. Then we're going to go to public comment. And if you would like to comment, there are these comment forms at the back of the room that it helps us keep track if you fill one out. So Director Meek.
So should the board desire to rescind the termination action of the retiree health plan that was achieved in November, based on the work of the retiree work group and on consultation with our health plan consultant, the staff recommendation is to continue to offer the current plan at the $922.56 per participant per month, fully paid by the participant, through December 31st, 2012, returning to the board with quarterly updates on the plan experience and funding levels. And we have that option as our recommendation on attachment 2. And you'll see that there is zero county liability, and meet and confer is not required, and there is no OPEB liability. So in terms of the CEO's recommendation in the best interest of the county, that is the recommendation. The recommendation continues to allow the approximate 60 non-Medicare eligible retirees who were participants in the program before the September action, which increased the rates and eliminated the subsidy, who subsequently dropped from the plan, to have the opportunity to re-enroll with an effective date of March 1st at the same premium rate of $922.56. Continues with a plan to return to the board in August, September 2012 with a possible renewal option for plan year 2013, based on the experience levels of the participant group and the status of the retiree health budget for the program. Then, should the board determine after review of the proposed renewal rates for plan year 2013, its desire to retain the retiree health plan for calendar year 2013, we'd like to confirm the board's original intent to terminate the retiree health plan effective December 31st, 2013, at which time the health care reform exchange program is expected to be implemented. Now, we're making these recommendations based on a number of factors that have changed since September and recent information. And that's based on Keenan's analysis determination that the $922.56 rate, which was determined for a larger group of 120, will serve for a group of 60, and that it should cover the full plan cost. It's also based on the analysis of the options reviewed by the work group and quantifying the barriers associated with continuation of a retiree health plan. It's also, let's see, based on the fact that the 922.56 rate includes recovering the anticipated $113,000 shortfall expected by December. However, this collection of this deficit will only occur if we have a 12-month plan, because it's built into the rates. The significant claims experience spike we noted in August and September of 2011 has decreased over the past few months. We recently received a $10,654 prescription drug formulary rebate from Medco, and there are future anticipated rebates of similar amounts. We have the anticipated $151,000 receipt of the ERP funds, and we are anticipating the current legislation of ERP funding so that the ERP funding will continue. The stop-loss marketing, which we just conducted, resulted in a 2% reduction for retirees, indicating a higher confidence level by the insurers in high claims payout. And it would also provide the retirees with a continued health care coverage over the next 12 months while they continue to research their personal options.
Thank you. Mr. Shoemaker, do you have a comment to wrap up your part of the presentation?
Yes. Well, this decision for you guys today is definitely a big balancing act. You know, you have a decision that's the outcomes and the risks are in your hands as a board. I mean, John is anxious to get at it. And what are the outcomes you want for your retirees and your employees, and then the risks for the county? How will we all be served? It sounds like we won't be canceling, which is a good point. But how will we all be served by a plan that's too expensive for a number of the folks in it and probably unsustainable versus a plan that is sustainable, has an upfront cost, or the other one maybe has a hidden cost, and, you know, makes us work through this 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 more times before we get to 2014. So we still believe with the changes they're even more beneficial financially for the blended plan, and we hope you would still consider to do that. And if you cannot go there, that you consider removing the payback of the 113 to reduce the premium of retirees from $922 and any other kind of added in costs that aren't relative to the plan year 2012 only. Reduce the cost to retirees if you're going to give them a plan. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there questions for clarification at this point? I have just one. The basis of the OPEB liability, if the county were to continue with the retiree recommendation, how does that liability manifest itself? Are those additional funds that the county would have to pay or potentially pay, or?
Now I'm wishing we had our Aon consultant here to answer that. So give me a second, I'm gonna pull out my notes on the OPEB.
Could you repeat that so I could hear the question better?
Well, I'm asking that with regard to the OPEB liability number that was listed in the comparison of the retiree alternative A, what is the basis of that OPEB liability? Is it funds the county would actually have to pay or would potentially have to pay? Or how would that be explained?
Right, so the OPEB liability is understanding that the Government Accounting Standards Board is not a legislative body. So they make recommendations so that across the country, all public agencies are booking their receivables and their liabilities the same way. So are there agencies that are not funding the liability and paying as you go this cost? Yes. Are there agencies that are funding the liability so they don't have to pay it, either now as they go or in the future? Yes. But the way that Aon structured it was that it would be booked for only 2 years, because at the end of 2 years, December 31st, 2013, the plan ends regardless. So if you continued it, it's already, as I understand it, been determined that at that date there is no longer a retiree plan. So, I mean, you would have this liability that if you do not fund it, could have, I don't work in the bond market, but could have potential adverse impact for you on your credit rating, on if you're looking to refinance a building. It's a liability that the banks, that the creditors look at and say, it's something that is there that is not being funded.
So it's a number on the balance sheet, but some of the GASB requirements require reporting, but don't necessarily require funding. So is this a situation where we are required to calculate and report the liability, but at December 31st, 2013, would we have to actually cough up that amount of money or not?
At December 31st, 2013, you would only have to cough up those dollars that you actually had incurred.
Okay. And that would be for the health claims and so forth? And
right, because the plan is going away. Now, yes.
So this is, in a sense, then, this is kind of an estimate of what the county might have to pay? I'm just... I understand this almost as well as John.
Yes, what I was going to comment is, because we're talking a two-year time frame, it really is similar to a cash flow analysis. So if you look at the chart where the county subsidy is $293,000, and then you look at the OPEB liability for a two-year period, it's almost double that. So
okay,
it's really
so
looking
essentially
at
essentially we're on a pay-as-you-go basis. Right, so that it might be that if the 293 is an accurate amount of what we need to pay to subsidize it and the employee contribution, the liability December 31st, 2013 might be actually zero. Could be. Supervisor Hamburg.
Well, the other thing that I thought Richard Shoemaker pointed out was that we currently have an OPEB liability of 120. No, what
we
was
had
the
one of $130 million
yeah.
4 years ago?
Had. Right, and today we have an OPEB liability of zero.
Because the OPEB, the liability that's being referred to is the implied subsidy. So when you blend those two plans together, the active plan is subsidizing the retiree plan. You're going from 922 to 576, and it is that. The easiest way to explain it is that implied subsidy is what your liability is, mm-hmm. because you are paying that as you move forward. I mean, you're on an as-you-go basis. If you decide to do that, you will be paying some part of that on a pay-as-you-go basis, and that's the $200,000 or I don't
know. $293,000.
Right. $293,000. You're going to pay it. It's not a number that's make-believe.
And that is so the difference between what the actives pay and what we would pay to subsidize what is currently the 922 cost for the retirees.
That's the simplest way to put it, because it also takes into consideration the number of active employees who are eligible to participate, who may participate. That's where Aon came up with the 63 lives. Okay. They have to take in a number of years before they retire. So there are a lot of factors that mm-hmm. come into play, but the easiest way to show it is that amount of the subsidy is what you're going to have to pay, because whether or not you blend them or they're not blended, it costs $12 million a year to cover everyone who's currently being covered.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Supervisor Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to go back to a couple points since I didn't ask questions earlier. This goes back to an earlier part of the conversation. But to counsel, on the meet and confer issue, you stated that you felt that meet and confer applied to both options A and B here. Could you explain that? I would certainly understand if any costs were passed on to the employees that it's an impact to wages and working conditions. So I understand that. How does that work if it's not an impact to the employees?
Well, I'm going to let Carmel explain how it could potentially be an impact to the employees. And based on the explanation that I got from staff, I came to that conclusion that there is the potential for impact. And she can explain the details as to that. But if there is a potential for impact, then it is a meet and confer issue.
Well, I understand that, but then I guess I need an understanding of what that is. Because in just the simplest terms.
To the executive officer.
Okay, thank you, Chair McCowan. Under B, I think, Supervisor Smith, that's what you're speaking to. If the retirees cover the $73,000, that would be the portion that the actives pay, then in looking at it black and white, one would think that there's no cost to the actives. However, what we know is that if we're talking about 60 to 120 retirees, that may have the highest cost claims, it's possible that the cost of the plan will be higher. So if the cost is higher, then there's a higher cost to the actives, and that would require a meet and confer.
I think I'd like a little more information on that. In other words, all of these, and that will get to my second point, which talks about us under any of these scenarios as being self-insured. But to the issue at hand, all of these, you know, it's just data analysis. It's actuarial data that then we make assumptions about and then take actions on and set rates, right? So all of this is speculative in saying that the 576 will cover it or the 922 will cover it. No one really knows until it occurs. That's just a fact. So, Ms. Angela, with that information, what could you explain again what I just really, because I have a pretty good working knowledge of labor, and so I just want to understand that analysis in the context of a requirement for meet and confer.
When you're dealing with the active employees, I think that it's incumbent upon the county that if there's any possibility of anything that impacts the active employee, that we share that information. And in this case, you know, we were talking to our labor consultants and also county council about, is this meet and confer? If there is any possibility under Plan B that the cost to the active employees is higher than what these numbers state here today, then that would require a meet and confer. So, you know, again, I'm not the attorney. I'm not making a legal decision here, but it would appear to me that the $73,000 is speculative, just as all these numbers are, and there's a possibility of a financial impact to the active employees. Thereby, it would be a discussion with the labor union.
Right. It's a change in the benefit. It's a change in the benefit by doing the blending, and if it has an impact, then it's obviously a meet and confer issue. But I don't know that you need to get hung up on the meet and confer aspect. It's not an impossible task.
No, I'm not hung up on it. I just want a clarification of with what CEO Angelo just said. That makes sense because you wouldn't really know if it had an impact till you did a retroactive analysis. I understand that.
Yeah, and Supervisor Smith, and if you look at the claims history, and when we came in November and said there wasn't enough money for the plan, at that time, I believe the claims were over $100,000 a month, and then the claims went down to about 30 or 40,000, and now we don't know what they are. So this is really, any blending is risky to the county. And so I think that's what we can see with the claims history.
So going on to my second point, and this would go to anyone at the table, it seems like as we go through the lists of from the retiree benefits group, they had a number of points that they were talking about that in totality would have a significant impact on the actual costs when they were the aggregate of those. So, but I think, and I'd like each party to comment, I think to a certain degree some of this is really semantics. Because we're self-insured, if we try to get hung up on the 40-some dollars for vision and dental, they don't have it. Yes, it would seem like a logical thing that then in a sense they're subsidizing the other retirees if they're not receiving it, but they're paying the same benefit, that it would all come out in the wash. But we're hearing from our consultant that no, it still stays the same. But in the end, and we dealt with this when I worked on the retiree health benefit issue years ago with retirees in Medicare and non-Medicare eligible, the same issue sort of arose in that which group was subsidizing whom. And so it does seem, though, that it will have an impact ultimately, and all you can do is speculate about it. But do we really need to focus on that? Because we just need to know it exists, and no one can really get any good data on it. But in the end, you know, it's really probably going to be a small difference. And do we care?
I can't answer the question of do you care. I mean, that obviously is, yeah. You have to decide. Yeah. But you are correct that because you are self-insured, and it's the reason you have the stop-loss insurance, because you are self-insured, at the end of the day, whether it's February 29th, whether it's December 31st, or whether it's December 31st, 2014, if there are claims outstanding that the premium has not been sufficient to cover, the county owns it.
Right.
Period, end of story. You are the plan sponsor, you own it.
In either scenario,
you own it.
Including if we were to make the decision to terminate, we would still face that for anything that comes in after February 29th. So
absolutely.
We'll be looking at that regardless.
For a year.
And it's probably more or less going to be in the same ballpark. I mean, we don't know.
We won't know. So typically the reason we want to have a 3-month stabilization reserve is so that in the event that the self-funded plan ends, there's a sufficient amount of money to cover those runout claims. Now, most of the provider contracts allow for 12 months from the date a claim is incurred for a physician or a hospital or a provider to submit that claim for reimbursement. In point of fact, those claims should all be in within the first quarter after the plan ends. And you know, you'll have some outliers, but they'll be insignificant as to, you know, the 3-month stabilization reserve should more than cover what those claims are.
Thank you.
And I did want to make a point about the stop loss. The $163,000 is an amount that's over 12 months. It's collected monthly. The plan ends February 22nd. You've paid 2 months worth of premium. The stop loss ends whenever the plan ends.
That's not what they told us, though.
The stop loss will end. Now, I and my firm would recommend that you purchase an additional runout reinsurance.
Here's the key.
And it would not be any, but it wouldn't cost anywhere near that, the remainder of that, you know, whatever the 10 months are, because we know that there is no stabilization reserve in the retiree plan.
Right. So with that, last comment.
I had one comment. Okay. And it has to do with the scenario that we're in, because we know this plan is ending either in February or 2013 or whatever date the board decides. We don't have the ability to adjust rates to address extreme fluctuations in claims experience. So for our active pool, we're able to adjust. It's an ebb and flow. And each year you analyze and you say, okay, based on this past experience, here's our rates. Because we're in this situation of knowing when the plan ends, we can't do that. So that's part of the problem of what we're dealing with and looking at how's plan run out going to work.
Well, we have to deal with that under any scenario.
We have to deal with it regardless of when we end it. It's, you know, we're going to have to deal with it.
Mr. Shoemaker.
And it was
last comment before we go to public.
Well, I just want to address the $42 number is not so much about we want to be paying $42 less. It's just the fact that the retirees are putting another $42 into the bucket that holds $13 million. They may not be getting service for it, but they're not deadbeats hanging on to everybody else. They're putting even more money in to make it work. So I think that's the biggest key about that $42.
Well, okay. The point is they're contributing that amount. Yeah. I don't think anyone was characterizing them the way you did. I think we were on the other side. I think folks were clarifying that it wasn't necessarily saving the county money. So both are true.
Well, it helps fund the service. Mm-hmm.
All right. With that, we will go to public comment. Gary Hudson and Terry Melvin will follow. If you have a card, please bring it forward to the clerk.
Been a long time. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Gary Hudson, retired sheriff's captain. I'd like to speak a little bit about how this affects people whose careers were cut short by injuries they suffered on the job, and in particular, safety members. When we signed up for this job, we certainly knew the risks, especially those of us who were employed as peace officers. We knew that there was a risk of being injured, and the extreme, a risk of dying on duty. We accepted that risk. We performed our services. We did so, hopefully all of us, with professionalism and dignity. Most of us will have suffered at least a few injuries by the end of our careers. I can only speak for myself. I can't speak for all the other employees, but over the course of 27 years, I've had at least four injuries that have gone through the workers' compensation process. They've been accepted by the county as workplace injuries. They've been rated by the Workers' Compensation Appeals Board. A disability rating has been calculated, and I've received some sort of settlement from the county for each of those injuries, and in all cases, an award of future medical care. However, each time I incurred an injury, now it poses a risk that I cannot get insurance because of a pre-existing medical condition. Private insurers don't care if you're injured on the job or while you're cleaning out your garage. And I have two injuries in particular where I've been told flat out it is not in my best interest to even apply for insurance because there is a database that insurers can access. And if you file for it and you are denied, your denial goes into a database that is then accessible by every insurance company you may want to apply for in the future. It's a catch-22. So now you'll have people who are, especially in the public safety sector, may not want to file an injury claim, even though they should, even though they have the right to, because it may prevent them from getting insurance in the future. You already have public safety members who are working beyond the safe years and may come to a point where their employer may have to force them out the door because they no longer meet the minimum qualifications. As Janine can tell you, because we've litigated these cases before, it's a long and difficult process. So we were hurt on the job. We were injured while we were on, we were insured while we were on the job. We can now no longer work. And because of our injuries that we suffered on the job, we cannot get insurance. Thank you.
Thank you. Terry Melvin, followed by Claudia Proctor, and each speaker will have 3 minutes.
Board members, everybody here, I don't know all the formalities, so I'm kind of like John Pinches. I shoot right from the hip, and here it is. And we wonder why insurance and medical costs are so expensive. If you just sit and listen to the mumble-jumble today, and all these people have a job to do.
Please address your comments to us.
Everybody's got a job to do here today, but we're throwing all these numbers out and this, you know, study and that study and on and on and on. Takes me back to the days when I was chief investigator of welfare fraud at social services, and we would go on day in and day out about stuff. And my attitude is, let's just jump in there and do it, and then we can make an adjustment afterwards. I'm at a loss. I've been making notes here, and 32 years with the county. I started with the county in 1969. I was 18 years old. They had a program where they hired college kids as laborers at Public Works, and it went from there to working at Juvenile Hall. I left for 5 years as a probation officer in Lake County, came back as a welfare fraud investigator, chief investigator for 6 years. I have medical conditions. I'm a severe diabetic. I'm on two kinds of insulins, oral medicines. I went through my costs the other day. Last year was $19,197 for 2011. My out-of-pocket was $9,073. 2012, Just the premium, if we continue on this 922, just the premium is going to be $11,000. You know, I've started liquidating some of the toys that I've had in my life, and it's a downward spiral, and it just scares me. And somewhere along the line, we lost out on, you know, we made a commitment to these people, and they came to work for us, and now it's like, you know, we're just turning our back on them. And I don't want you to do that. You know, we made an effort, and in the long run was, you know, we were looking at this. People didn't come to the county in 1969 for the wages. Trust me. They came for the benefits. They came for the retirement. They came for the sick leave. And they came for the 2 weeks and up to 5 weeks kind of program. They didn't come here for the money. I was married, had four kids, and took up $200. I'll never forget those days when I lived on the Eel River, and I drove to Fort Bragg to Public Works to drive dump truck. You know, came home, went to my mom's, took a shower, got a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, went down to Foot Sporting Goods and Liquor, and worked till midnight. Went home, went to bed for 5 hours, got up, got in the truck, and drove back to Fort Bragg and drove dump truck, because that's all that was there. That was 1975. There weren't any jobs. There were no jobs in this county, you know. So don't turn your back on us, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Claudia Proctor, followed by Dave Bankston.
My husband and I were both employees for the county for 34 years. Luckily, we're both healthy. But we feel that you should do your best by the employees that worked for you for a long period of time are now eligible for retirement. Some retired specifically because they were not feeling well and felt that it would be better to leave jobs for those who could continue to work because you were reducing employees. That made an impact on many departments and who retired and when they retired. That if I leave now, then others will be able to keep their job. We understood when we took our jobs that we would not be paid well, but that there would be benefits that would come with it. I think that you not only have to consider the financial impact to the county, but also your moral obligation to the people that worked for you. And keep that in mind when you make this decision.
Thank you. Dave Bankston, followed by Greg Foss.
I worked for the county for 36 plus years, a long time. And during that time, I had a lot of opportunities to leave and take other jobs. And that's one of my concerns, that I based life decisions and career decisions based upon, well, there's a pension at the end of this, and there's health insurance at the end of this. To begin with, I could have gone to work for General Electric. I could have stayed in the Butchers Union. When I became the assistant commissioner, I got a job from another county to double my salary. I got a job offer from the federal government for an immense amount of money at the beginning of my career. I got another one towards the end of my career. And in the last year of my employment, somebody came and asked me if I'd go to work for him. And they offered me a lot of money, about 150 grand. I said, no, I don't want to do that. I'll lose my health insurance. I also convinced other employees not to take jobs because they would lose their health insurance. And I have a question to you talking about what you're going to have to go to the table and bargain with employees for.
To the board, and then we can.
To the board. If you make a decision that breaks 35 years worth of promises and MOUs, and I'm an existing employee of Mendocino County, I'm going to go, what is any MOU worth?
And to the board.
To the board. Yeah, if you can break all these promises, the whole, you know, that go back 35 years for me, then I'm going to be questioning, you know, your ability to keep promises with me. No matter what you do today, I'm going to go, hey, wait a minute, what's this MOU worth? What's this promise worth?
Thank you. Greg Foss, followed by Carol Mordhorst.
Good afternoon, Greg Foss speaking today. I would like to start by thanking Pat Meek and her staff for putting this work group together. They really did an excellent job, and they should be commended for that. And I heard Peter say at least three times that he didn't have any skin in this game, but I'd submit to you that he left a lot more of that behind at the table. The term death spiral has kind of stuck with me, and I'm sure with a lot of others. It's resonated to my soul. And what I began to think about was that if you enact a plan that's not affordable for the remaining retirees, the pre-65ers, you're not only striking a stake in the heart of just those 100, 150, the number's kind of moving around 300, but you're driving a stake in the heart of the people of Mendocino County. You're talking about people that lived here for many years, 10, 20, 30 years of employment. They raised families here. They shop at the Habitat, Schatz, Rod's Shoes. They are now having to take that money, that discretionary money, and use it for health care. So in a sense, if you do this, one of the intangible things that I'd like you to think about is you're making an investment in the county, not just in the 100 people or however many will be portion of their premium will be offset by whatever amount you determine. But really, that money is staying in the community. Otherwise, you're going to have over 100 people who may have to consider leaving, bankruptcy, and all kinds of things. That's going to continue to degrade the quality of life that directly affects the employers of this county, outside of county employment, the private sector. It's going to affect them. And I would say one other thing about meet and confer. It's my understanding that you are able to identify that the costs differential between actives and pre-65ers. If that's true, and there's a spike in claims, it really isn't a burden that has to be borne by the actives, because you are, pick a number, 300,000, going to supplant or pay a portion of our premiums, and it spiked. And let's say in 13, it's now 320. You don't pass the 20 back to the actives. You just now have to come up with 320 instead of 300. So you're still not impacting the actives. You are isolating our health claims, and if they might go down. Have you thought that they actually might go down? And you might save some money that you could then reapply. So I would submit that you relook at this plan in a year, at the end of this year, and say, what were our actual costs? Still no impact to the actives, because, oh, it did spike, but now we just have to come up with something. I'm not saying it's not a liability. I'm just saying that's something to consider. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Carol Mordhorst, followed by Marcia Wharf.
My name's Carol Mordhorst, and now I think, as Richard indicated, it's been difficult that these numbers keep moving around. But based on the information that I've heard today, it appears that the county got federal reimbursement for the retiree plan. You know, initially got payment, some that they owe back. They got another one out there pending. But it sounds like for the year of 2011 that the county will get approximately $396,000. So I would suggest to the board to get answers to two questions from the consultant. What, if any, amount of federal reimbursement was assumed in this blended rate calculation for 2012? And if the federal money is available for $15,000 to $90,000 for the retirees, what he would anticipate the likely impact would be on the blended plan, either the costs or the premiums, as a result of federal recoupments. I have said to the board on numerous occasions, I've sort of been the communication link with a lot of these people in the audience. I probably know more about health issues of my fellow retirees than anybody in this room. But I'm also very concerned about the stories that I have heard from the people that dropped before, the people that now have had to drop in the fall at the time that the premiums went up to 922 and there was no longer any subsidy, that, you know, there's 60 people that have significant health issues that are going without. And I've heard stories about fear of loss of houses and, you know, people that are downsizing and are using their IRAs and everything else to cover this. And then now we have 60 people left on the plan. And I did a survey of those people saying, if you continued, what would you want to continue to pay this 922? And I'm hearing from even more of them that say, yeah, I stayed on, but I can't afford to continue to stay on. And so at what point in time would a number be too low that you would say, you know what, we can't do it any longer, even if you continue it today?
Thank you. Marcia Wharf, followed by Kyle Knopf.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. Supervisor Pinches, this is for you. We've been dealing with all this paperwork, and there's not one number that's the same from the time we started till today. In fact, we got the latest numbers a few minutes before the meeting started. So just be happy you only have the few papers in front of you that you do, and that you didn't have to wade through everything that we did. I worked for the county for 32 and a half years. My name is Marcia Wharf, retired assessor, county clerk, recorder. We decided to recommend the blended plan for the simple reason that we represented all of our retirees, not just the few people that are left on the plan. And the 60 people who had to drop it because they simply couldn't afford it. Now, I've heard it mentioned many times when talking about the 922, well, there's the 60 or 70 people who can still afford to pay the 922. No, they can't afford to pay the 922. They're stuck paying the 922 because they can't get insurance anywhere else. So they're not paying other bills is what it amounts to. When I retired at the beginning of 2008, I paid $500 for my husband and nothing for me for health insurance. That went to $1,845 this month. Now, I make a good retirement. It still cuts us very short. And for people that don't make anywhere near the retirement that I made, they had to drop. We have to cover these people. As you remember, you should remember that I've come to you a number of times before talking about blending. Blending is the only real solution to keep the system affordable for those of us that need insurance. And I urge you to do the blending and pick one of our choices today. Thank you.
Thank you. Kyle Knopf.
Chair McCowan, members of the board, Kyle Knopf with the executive office. We just wanted to bring a little bit of context both for the board's benefit and for members of the public regarding the the idea and the concept of obligations versus the available resources of the county over the long term. As your board is aware, the county is heading into the 12-13 fiscal year budget build. And right now, over the past few days, there have been some very expensive decisions made over the past few days. For example, the Mendocino County Board of Retirement met last week and adopted retirement cost percentages, moving from roughly 19% blended retirement rate to 23.3. That's a 20% increase for next year.
In a dollar amount, do you have that?
That will be pinned down as the budget process moves forward. I don't have a number for you right now. Earlier today, your board voted on the loss of our 9.31 permit revenue. That's roughly a $600,000 to $1 million annual loss for 12-13. Significant. We have buck errors in the county's retirement, roughly $600,000 to $750,000 impact that starts coming in for FY 12-13. we have health care costs for the regular employees currently employed by the county, roughly 8%.
And a dollar figure to that, or too early to tell?
Countywide, it's probably too early to tell, but it wouldn't exceed probably $1 million. Retiree health extended payments that you've already made on this issue, over $100,000.
But that'll be regardless.
Right. That's for this year. Yeah, your county's revenues are still static. Property tax is in decline. And as your board is aware, your property tax is the source of 70% of your board's discretionary revenue to run this county. Your county continues to face downward pressure from the state, downward pressure from the federal government in terms of your fiscal relationship with those two governments. So just trying to put a little bit of context into the overall picture of the county's financial situation and the challenges that the county continues to face into the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone who has not yet spoken who would like to address the board on this issue? Please come forward. And we'll Linda Nagel first, and then Sue Thornhill. And is there anyone else? Okay, so you will be the last speaker.
I wasn't going to speak, but I just feel like I need.
Please,
oh,
for the
I'm
record.
Linda Nagel, a recent retiree, and I just feel a need to really encourage the board to consider one of the two retirement health group options, the blended function, the blended options. I think it's essential. I agree with one of the previous speakers that it is a moral issue. It's a commitment that has been made years and years ago to this group. I know there's many people less fortunate than I in terms of being in a family that has two pensions and has a better ability to afford premium costs. I have people very close to me who have had to go on to the county's medical CMSP program because of not being able to afford the cost of the health insurance premiums. I think the cost is beyond just to the county, that $300,000 or whatever it is, or the individuals. It's a cost to our community. It's a cost to what we can do and continue to do within our community in terms of being able to support our local economy, to support you know, those around us. A lot of us donate to our local charities, etc. It's a community issue, and we are part of that community, and I respectfully request your consideration.
Thank you. Sue Thornhill.
Oh.
Sorry. Modern technology.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I've been sitting here listening, and I have to tell you, I'm fighting.
Yourself.
I'm sorry. Sue Thornhill, retiree. I'm finding myself very emotional. I've been fighting back tears through this entire process. I know what a difficult position you're in, and I hope you realize what a difficult position we've all been in. For 20 of the 28 and a half years I worked for the county, I sat and listened to some of the saddest stories I have ever heard in my entire life. I know these people, I know their stories. I'm asking you, I know also the financial condition this entire country is in. You know, we all, it's no secret to us as our dollars dwindle. But I will ask you, as you consider the dollar signs, please put in the forefront the people that are sitting here today. Thank you.
Thank you. And the last lady in the back, please. And please state your name for the record.
At the board, my name is Annette O'Brien Fashauer. I have lived in this county all my life. My family dates back to the 1850s in this county. I worked for the county with the assumption that I'd have insurance when I retired. Now I wonder why I have continued to live in Mendocino County. I, as Marcia Worf has said, she has a retirement check that can afford the 922. I don't. I get billed separately. That's all I have to say. Please consider us.
Thank you. Are there any, I think we've kind of heard the final comment from staff and Mr. Shoemaker. We heard from the executive office. Is there any very brief last comments that anyone would like to make?
Question?
Mr. Shoemaker.
It's a
Can you hear?
There we go. The $396,000 that came back for ERP, that was for the year 2010, is that right?
$334,000 was for 2010, and that's the number that's actually in question right now. And then we got another 67 that is part of, or the first part of 2011.
Okay. And those repayments, were they in the 922 calculations, or did, were the calculations made on just out expenses out?
The 334 was, the 60 something was not, because that came after the calculations were complete.
And then the 151 that we're still looking for would
absolutely
that,
not.
But that could be easily applied to the 922.
Well, keep in mind the 922 is with the exception of the 113,000 to recover the deficit from the 2011 plan year, is meant to cover cost going forward,
okay,
not backwards. The 151,000 that's coming for plan year 2011 can be used for a number of things relative to the retiree program, deficit reduction.
Did that be put against the 113?
It could be.
I think what you're asking is, were all of these possible payments from the ERP fund factored in to coming up with the 922 and the cost that that would represent to the county?
Well,
or in other words, can any of these funds be used to offset the projected loss to, or cost to the county?
That's the basic premise, because if you took the 151 and put it against the 113, you could factor that 113 out of the 922, if I'm not mistaken.
And is that accurate? Sue Goodrich seems to think so.
But these are the kind of dilemmas we faced, and that's why I'm telling you that 293 is kind of a top-end number. And all this other stuff that we've talked about today and we've put in the proposal before you are opportunities to reduce that 293 if you're
working.
And
we're trying to identify specifically what some of those are.
Yeah, thank you.
The dollars that are coming back from reimbursement for claims in the 2011 year are not meant to cover the cost of future years. So in the event, as an example, I have several clients, counties
Well, if I may interrupt, so therefore the reimbursement for 1011 is money the county would already get to offset costs the county has incurred.
In 1011.
Right. And so that the county is already, if it's going to get that money, it's going to get it anyway without continuing the program.
The $151,000 will only come to
if,
the county.
If we continue, but whether we go with the executive office recommendation or the retiree recommendation, we would be eligible for that reimbursement.
Yes.
And that reimbursement was not factored into the 293?
The $151,000 was only submitted for reimbursement 2 months ago. So
right.
No,
so it's
not.
So it's not part of the calculations here?
Correct.
Okay. Any other board member with a question for clarification, then board member discussion or action? Supervisor Pinches.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, Kyle, our an administrative office analyst got up and told us about the budgetary problems short-term that we have coming up. We have these budgets. I remember when Kyle first came to work, maybe before he came to work here a couple of years ago, him or somebody else got up and said, well, we have about $10 or $12 million worth of short-term problems that we had to deal with, and we dealt with them. Our real financial situation in Mendocino County is we got long-term debt that we have to pay to the tune of just over $10 million that's going to extend out to 2028. I'm not so saying that was bad borrowed money, but it was done. It's an obligation that we're going to have to continue to meet. 70% of the people of this county told us 2 years ago that we didn't want any development to the north end of the valley here, and so that costs probably about $2 million a year in economic development dollars coming right to this county. So, but you know, these are issues that here at this board we have to deal with, and we'll deal with them. We've made significant strides, I feel. Just this last year, we got basically exited and finished the process of getting out of all lease buildings, and that's going to save federal and state dollars and local dollars about $1 million a year. You know, we just last week made a decision with our wastewater, and it's going to save us about $100,000 just in a couple of bills that we're not going to be able to have to pay. So we're making headway in that thing. So when it comes right down to this issue of taking care of retirees, it really comes down to what's the priority. And I think when we talk about the county of Mendocino, we can talk about our roads or our law enforcement, everything, but it really comes down to the working men and women of the county, what really makes Mendocino County what it is. And I'm not willing to, you know, we had to reduce our existing county employees' salary by 10%. And that wasn't a decision that I don't think anybody up here wanted to do, but it was necessary. You know, and then when it comes to the retirees' health, which we're talking about today, it comes down to really the priority. And I was just thinking, you know, I'm not proud to say this, but we've really spent more in taking better care of our closed landfills than we have our county retirees. And that's a sad fact. But that's, you know, somebody says, well, the law makes you do this and the law makes you do that. But it really comes down to who do we need to take care of. And I respect a lot of the work of the county retirees, whether they worked here for the county for 35 years or two and a half years. But I'm not willing to kick them off the bus, and I want to, I'm going to throw out a motion because I think it's just an obligation. We're going to have to come up with it and pay, but I'm going to make a motion to support the fully blended plan.
That would be option A of
option A of the retiree recommendation.
We have a motion. Is there a second to the motion?
I'll second for discussion.
So we have a motion by Supervisor Pinches, seconded by Supervisor Hamburg. Is there a discussion to the motion?
Just a question. And that is, I guess, conditional on the meet and confer process, right?
So that's part of the discussion.
Yes.
How would that work if that requires meet and confer a minimum of 30 days?
Well, it'd be a condition of the motion. It'd be a condition of approval.
Well, but meanwhile, if we don't do something, the plan expires March 1st. So how do you make a conditional motion?
Well, I think it was stated by county council that 30 days ought to be a reasonable time.
You could extend the current plan.
Well, I'm asking, does that present a problem?
Okay. We can send a letter and invite the bargaining units to discuss, and then it's going to depend on the results of that meeting and the reception we get. So we can do that within 30 days. Whether we get agreement and then whether we have to go into some sort of negotiation on this then could take much longer. So,
but we could still be continuing the plan while that negotiation
that would be an option to
occurring.
Continue the plan with direction to engage in meet and confer and see where we go.
Thank you. And I don't know who was first between the two.
I think Supervisor Hamburg.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the reasons that I seconded Supervisor Pinch's motion is that I think that a lot of these issues that are raised in the work group's report, particularly those on page 7, really can't be ignored. mean, if you have a system set up that de-incentivizes people retiring, you know, when they've already reached the point where they're they've really been productive employees, it seems like what the county is doing is setting itself up for having to pay higher costs to take care of those employees. And, you know, I think that's a very real concern. It's hard to quantify it in a person-by-person or incident-by-incident level, but we're definitely better off with a younger, healthier workforce than we are with an older, more infirm workforce in every way, in terms of the overall productivity of our employees and also in terms of what we have to pay for our various benefit plans. The other concern I have, and maybe County Council can speak to it, is the commitments that this county made over a period of many, many years with respect to retiree health care. And I would not be shocked if those who are adversely affected by a board decision to discontinue this plan or to continue it even you know, at this rate, which I think many people find onerous, if not impossible to pay, doesn't put us in a rather dicey situation. County Council, do you want to comment on
well,
that?
Well, and I don't know that you were here when, maybe last year when I made the statement. It's not a very popular one, but my predecessor, and as well as myself, have consistently opined that there is no vested right or to the health insurance benefit. That being said, I think that's still the position we're mm-hmm. taking today, and until such time as I can be convinced otherwise through documentation or agreements that people mm-hmm. seem to talk about that never materialize, that's the position we're going to maintain.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the position that Mr. Klein maintained as well.
Seems to me there was a recent court case that
court case only dealt with the issue of whether or not you can have an implied in fact agreement with your employees as opposed to an actual contract. Mm-hmm. And what that court decision said is it's up to every county to make that determination. That court decision did not say that there's a vested right to health care.
Mm-hmm.
That court decision says that you can have an implied in fact agreement with your employees. And then that court decision sent it back to the Supreme Court, sent it back to the federal court, and now they'll have to have a trial as to whether or not there is truly a vested right. So,
okay. Well, of course, regardless of whether there's a vested right, you know, there's another issue there, which is the you know, moral or ethical obligation that the county incurred, and several people have spoken to that and career decisions that they made based on what they at least felt. And I think if I had been a prospective employee reading you know, that county manual, I would have drawn the same conclusion.
Supervisor Brown, was your question answered? Or
well, no, it's not, because in the letter we received from the retirees committee, there was an indication that perhaps going to meet and confer might take less than 30 days, might be very quick. And so I would like to extend it. I would like to hear back from those groups and what they are feeling at this time before we make any decision.
Well, except it would take 30 days after we send the letter to get an answer, and that'll put us right about at the time the
but
plan
perhaps
would expire.
Perhaps they would come back. Well, is there a possibility of an extension? And perhaps the groups would come back in 15 days if we got the letter out.
I personally think we should be making a decision today. I mean, and it sounds as if staff does not feel it's really a concern with the meet and confer process possibly going on while we're in the process of doing whatever we do.
I don't think so. When I say 30 days, I'm just saying in terms of good faith bargaining, that's a realistic time frame to get information out and get them, you know, and have set up meetings. If you limit it to a five-day turnaround, that's, you know, the union's going to object to that. because that's not enough time for folks to get together and be informed and get the information and the documentation that they need.
I didn't say five, I said 15.
Well, even that, I think 30 days is reasonable. Certainly they could respond before then.
Supervisor Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And this is to the motion and primarily procedural. First question is, do we have to take any action to rescind our previous action? Because we have a previous action in place of termination. So to take any other future action, subsequent action, I think we need to rescind our previous one. Okay, so while they discuss, I'll go on.
Well, the motion assumes that.
And perhaps when we have clarified where the board's going, then staff can craft the appropriate motion.
Exactly. We can
the
take
motion
a short,
assumes that.
Well, let's make
short,
sure.
We can take a short break to do that. That's often useful. And we've been in here considerably long period of time anyway.
You would need to take action to rescind. She just showed me the agenda.
That's why I raised that question. So, okay, so again, to the motion. So that would be a procedural thing we need to cover. And then secondly, I think that we need to be realistic about meet and confer with a large number of bargaining units and reasonable time frames to complete that process. So I think that if we would need to continue the current retiree plan for an additional 30 days, perhaps maybe we ought to talk about that, consider that. We don't know. Maybe that'll be a very straightforward process. We'll hear from all the bargaining units and we'll wrap that up in 20 days. And maybe we're going to be hearing all kinds of discussion, and it won't be as smooth as one would like to think. So that's an unknown, and here we are in the moment trying to craft a motion. So, Mr. Chair, with your concurrence, I would like to get a sense from the rest of us, the two that we know, the position of the two that made the motion, on looking at A and B and the realistic. Where do board members stand? Because I think both A and B are viable alternatives. They're both versions of the same. I just wanted to make sure we cover the, we have to rescind prior action, make sure that there's seamless coverage, give adequate time for meet and confer process. And then I'd like to have a discussion about A and B and various members' thoughts on it.
Well, we have a motion on the floor by two members in favor of option A, so if you'd indicate your preference, that'll get us down the road.
Well, I could go either way on that. I think that A is
and go my way.
A positive way to go, and I also think that the $663 premium is less burdensome to the county, and it is still a great reduction from the 922. I could see that one either way, and want to hear from the rest of you.
Okay, so Supervisor Brown. We'll finish the poll here, and then we'll come to you.
Well, I have to say that I would probably favor the B, because it is. A shared cost, and we have individuals that have gone off and gotten other policies. We're changing a little bit here and helping those that cannot or actually cannot afford anything higher. So I would be more in favor of B.
And it is a compromise.
Yes, it is.
I have a question before Mr. Shoemaker's question, and do those retirees who have sought other options have the opportunity to come back into this plan if we continue it?
It's a board policy decision. Generally, the opt-in, opt-out rules require that anybody opting in has had health insurance for 6 months, I believe, prior to the opt-in. What we were suggesting in the staff recommendation is those retirees who opted out from September on be allowed to opt back in March 1st, even if they didn't have coverage.
Right.
And there's a certain risk to that, but it seemed a reasonable thing to
because
do.
Because the assumption is they were opting out for economic reasons.
Right.
So our policy, present policy, is they could opt back in if they wanted to.
Well,
if
the
they had coverage for 6 months prior.
The recommendation is those who opted out from September on could opt back in. And were the 63 persons who were assumed to be ready to retire in the next 2 years, in developing the premium estimates, it was factored in that they would actually retire or not?
No.
Two separate studies.
One was based on expected premium of the existing group. The future cost in terms of what you're referring to from Aon was completely separate, assuming that, because in order to determine what the full value of that implicit subsidy is, they have to identify those who are eligible and likely to participate. That's where that 63 comes in. But when looking at the premium, when we did our renewal calculations for what would be necessary for next, you know, this current calendar year, absolutely were not considered. Only the membership that was participating at the time,
which was around 120. Right now the enrollment's about 64 70, so we're okay in that range, because 922 will serve both size groups, because again, it's the credibility factor. It's zero, so it doesn't have a big impact on the rates for this small of a pool.
But if half of the people who are assumed to be eligible or willing to retire, if only half of them were to join, it would increase the cost to the county approximately 50%, because the 293 number is based on approximately 60 people.
74.
Okay. So then we need to bear in mind that if we do approve the retiree option A or B, it will likely increase the county cost. And I apologize, Supervisor.
No. I just want to get clear on that. That will increase the county cost if the numbers go up above an additional 63 out of the 293?
The chart where it shows the 293 subsidy per year, it was based on 74 enrolled. So if there are more people enrolled, then it's going to increase the county subsidy.
Then the county cost would go up.
And that's kind of a different conversation than the rates. So I was just speaking about the rates won't change because the pool's so small. Mm-hmm. The subsidy will if the number of retirees in the plan increases.
Mm-hmm. And Pat, do you have any sense, looking at these two options, of which one would be more likely to clear a meet and confer consideration?
That's a good question. I would think, and this is just my opinion, that if the actives were asked not to have higher premium rates, therefore not subsidizing, that would probably go over better. But, you know, I really don't know.
In other words, you think option B would be more popular with the actives?
If popular at all, yeah.
If popular at all. Does anyone else have a contrary view on that?
Well, I'd like to comment.
Well, just a second.
Sure.
I would like to hear his comment.
Okay. So, Mr. Shoemaker.
So, option B should not be on this piece of paper. And the reason it should not be on this piece of paper is because it was created to eliminate current employee subsidization of the retirees and keep it out of meet and confer. It failed to do that. The only reason it was created was to keep this out of meet and confer. If we had known that B would not keep it out of meet and confer, we never would have worked for 3 hours to create it. So if you pick it up as an option, you're picking it up as an option as a stray cat or something. I don't know how to describe it. But before this was published on Wednesday, we always thought there would be no meet and confer. And the other committee members can verify that. I think I've said that to one other person, that it's too late to take it off the sheet. We'll just move forward.
So now it's a stray cat without anyone claiming parentage, but it's kind of a compromise between the retiree recommendation and the executive office recommendation.
No, I would say it's not. I will repeat myself.
Well, it's in between.
Well, okay. The number is in between, but we did it to eliminate one of those hurdles. And You know, if you don't have to go over a river, you don't build a bridge.
However it came about, it exists on paper.
That's true, it does.
It's within the purview of the board to consider.
That's true, it does.
So,
with it saying that, anything for this board to consider, and they don't have to be on the sheet of paper.
That's correct, too. And we're going to come back to this motion in a second, but does the executive office have any additional comment at this point? Have you heard anything that would change the recommendations that you would make, or?
Thank you, Chair McCowan. I think a lot of work has gone into today, and this is not easy for this board, I'm well aware of that, or for the retirees sitting in the chamber today. I would say that in reviewing all of the information and in dealing with this issue over the past year or so, that my recommendation stands at the $922.56 premium a month. And the reason for that is that every dollar that this board spends on retiree health care is a dollar that doesn't go into services today. With that, I understand the issue and the importance of this issue to the board. I think that the 922 is the least risky to the county, and that's my job to provide you with that information. I think fully blending the plan with the retirees and the actives could be risky to this county, more so than we know today. We have not fully researched that, and I think it could be problematic. And I would stick with the recommendation of the 922.56. That's all I have to say.
Supervisor Pinches, well, and then myself.
I'm going to stick up for my motion here. And one thing that rides, thinking back, if you remember this, the fiscal year that we're in right now, the 11-12 budget year, I have the exact numbers in my office, but I think it's around the $600,000 range that left that money available to spend in this year's budget for services. And we derived that $600,000 from savings in our workman's comp and general liability insurance, the actuary, because basically the county employees, and when you talk about workman's comp plans, that includes some retired employees too. The claims are way down. So it was because of the employees that we were able to allow $600,000 more in services in this fiscal year through our savings and the actuarial and the liability of workman's comp and general liability. So, you know, so I look at this cost of taking, say, $300,000 a year out of our service side. You know, it's not all, there's a good side of it too. And even though it's a general pot of money, it's all insurance payments that the county makes, whether it's, you know, whether it's health insurance premium payments, workman's comp, or general liability, it still comes out of our general fund. So that just props up my argument.
Well, my comment is that I am very concerned that the numbers that we're looking at, the 293 potentially, the 219 potentially, although there's a potential for some adjustments downward, there's a potential for fairly significant adjustments upward. If, for instance, all 63 of the people were to take retirement and go on to this plan, it under option A, that could drive the cost up approximately $220,000 to $230,000. Under option B, it would drive it up approximately $180,000 or so, $180,000, if all 63 opted to retire. So this board, the 3 years I've been here, we've made a lot of bad decisions. They were the best bad decisions that we could make in many cases, and they had negative impacts on every single one of our employees at this point and every single one of our retirees at this point. And I think following with the CEO's recommendation would be consistent with the bad decisions that we've previously made. They were bad in terms of the being forced into doing something we would rather not have done, and bad in terms of the impact that it had onto the people affected. But I think those decisions have been necessary to try and maintain the fiscal solvency of the county. So, and I, this may not represent a majority position on the board, but I think that's where I am. We'll have a comment from Supervisor Brown, and then I think it's to the makers of the motion to clarify what their motion will be. Supervisor Brown.
Thank you, Chair McCowan, and thank you for explaining how awful and the decisions are the last 3 years that we have had to make. Yeah, there was difficult decisions, and we made a lot of them. I want to thank the CEO for sticking with her recommendation. This board has looked back in history and thought for some of the financial obligations we're faced with today. What in the world were they thinking? Were they given all the information, the board at the time? So I just want all five of us to recognize the fact our CEO and our chief financial officer have given us a lot of information. So this decision, not that it's going to be an impact 10 years down the road, it may, I don't know that. But I want every one of us to recognize what our vote means, and to recognize the fact that the Board of Supervisors have been given a lot of information, not only by administration, but also the retirees, and I want to thank you also. Gave me some quick lunchtime reading. but I can tell you put a lot of work into it and a lot of thought, and I hope your fellow retirees thank you for that. Certainly you have a turnout today. But administration is telling us what the impact will be. I myself favor B.
Supervisor Pinches and then Smith.
Well, Mr. Chair, I think before we go into a detail and take a break here and come up with a refine the motion to come back, maybe if you'd poll the board members to see where they want to go. I mean, it's public expression has been closed now. You can do that now, because we don't want to spend a lot of time to take a break with that for a motion
that's
not
going down.
Exactly.
So if you. Okay, we'll hear from Supervisor Smith, then we'll poll the board, and perhaps we can start the polling with Supervisor Smith as well.
Thank you, although I do believe we have a motion on the floor
we
currently.
We do, but that motion could be amended, and the mayor has indicated he may be willing to adjust it.
No sense in going forward with a formal motion if it doesn't have three votes to pass. So,
yes, Supervisor, and that would be exactly to my point. I would like to ask the maker of the motion, the second, to consider option B instead of A. I think it is somewhat more prudent, although it does create the avenue for more affordable health care for retirees. To Chair McCowan's points on these dollars could go up, both A and B. Obviously, B is going to go up to some degree, far is going to go up less than A. So I think it is a more prudent course of action, and it still supports the retirees in getting affordable health care. I think a lot of good comments have been made here today. So that would be my request for the maker of the motion and the second, to consider option B.
So I think that was option B. Supervisor Brown had indicated support for option B.
So it's up to you.
Well, I indicated support for the CEO recommendation, but if option B were on the table, I would support it.
Well, and it's
up to you two.
That's that's not my first choice, but I want to leave here with something for our retirees. So, if my motion doesn't have the third vote, then there's no sense in taking a break and come up with a formal motion.
I think you just heard, Supervisor, it doesn't, so I requested that you revise your motion to make it option B and that the second concurs.
The best 3 years of my life was the fourth grade.
No, it was in first grade. That's what you said last time.
So I can count to three, but I can't count to three today, so we'll.
Well, I think we're at five, potentially. If Supervisor Hamburg, the maker of the second, would support a revision of the motion to reflect option B and the other necessary actions, including rescinding the previous termination.
Why don't we do it this way? Why don't, because it's obvious I don't have the third vote, why don't I just rescind the motion, and then somebody else can make a motion for option B?
Well, that's your preference. You do have the option to have the motion be in favor of option B. That would probably pass. Sounds like it'd be unanimous. But you can also rescind the motion, and we can start over.
So you're going to give me the opportunity to make the
motion you don't want to make.
I'll say, yeah, it was like John Pinches.
I'll do that. If I can't get it all, I'll take something, yeah.
So you're willing to have Kraft staffed a motion that would reflect support for option B and the necessary other actions that would go with that?
Yes, reluctantly.
And is that acceptable to the maker of the second?
Yes.
I rescind the motion?
Pardon?
We didn't take an action. I just took a motion.
The chair included
that. There was no
that.
Action.
Okay. The chair included that in the motion. The other associated.
Yes.
And so, we would take a break and they'd
So let's come
that,
back
right?
with a motion. With it.
Yes. And so we will take hopefully a 7-minute break for staff to craft the appropriate motion and for Supervisor Pinches and Hamburg to review that motion, make sure we've all got
it. Ask your audience if everybody's clear on what's going on.
Is everyone clear? So we're going to take a brief break and come back with a motion. Minute recess, longer than that, but we do have a motion, and we will have the clerk read the motion, and there has been one amendment to what is on the page that the clerk will note as we go through.
Who's making the motion, though? I thought you, is it?
Well, it's Supervisor Pinch's motion, but
okay.
Seconded by Supervisor Hamburg.
Okay, so with respect to paragraph 2, it should end at 2013. So delete at which time the health care reform exchange program is expected to be implemented.
Okay, so this motion as written, before we have the clerk read it, as written, does this reflect the motion that Supervisor Pinches would like to, or is willing to make with the second by Supervisor Hamburg?
I have a comment, Mr. Chair.
Well, we'll get there. Or maybe we'll just have the clerk read it and then you can both confirm that that's the motion that is on the floor. Will that work? Supervisor Pinches?
Yeah.
So the clerk will please read the motion that has been prepared.
I haven't actually received a motion by either supervisor. The last motion was rescinded, so.
Well, yeah, so this is the actual motion, and that's what. Pardon?
Yes.
Okay.
Pinches and Hamburg.
Supervisor Pinches and Supervisor Hamburg.
Okay. Motion by Supervisor Pinches, seconded by Supervisor Hamburg, to number one, accept presentation from staff and retiree health plan work group on recommendations on termination and alternatives to the termination of the non-Medicare eligible retiree health plan effective February 29, 2012. Two, confirm the board's intent to terminate retiree health plan effective no later than December 31st, 2013. Three, that the board rescinds their earlier decision to terminate the plan effective February 29, 2012, that was made on November 15, 2011, and approve the retiree health plan work group proposal number B, subject to meet and confer effective April 1st, 2012. The board further extends the current plan at $922.56 per participant, fully paid by participant through March 31st, 2012. 2A, allow for the approximate 60 non-Medicare eligible retirees who were participants in the retiree health plan in September 2011 prior to the notification of the rate increase and elimination of the county subsidy, who subsequently dropped from the plan to have the opportunity to re-enroll with an effective date of April 1st, 2012, to be returned to the board with quarterly updates on plan experience and funding levels, and returned to the board in August and September 2012 with a possible renewal option for plan year 2013.
And does that reflect the motion that Supervisor Pinches and Hamburg are willing to make? Is that your motion, Supervisor?
I believe so.
Just the only change is on paragraph three, the last line, 922.56 per participant, fully paid by participants. I think that's should be an S on the end.
By participants.
So yeah, noted.
I think there's a parentheses there. It should be an S.
Okay, so right? An S instead of parentheses. Is that looks right?
Yes.
There's no need for an end of parentheses there. There's no beginning to it. So
correct.
That should just be an S.
Correct.
Okay.
And then Supervisor Smith, and then myself.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This was just on the wording. I would think that on number three, it should say to terminate the retiree health plan, just so that's very clear, instead of just saying to terminate the plan. Or it could say the current retiree plan. That would just be a little bit clearer. And then I'm questioning and would like a response from the makers of the motion, I guess, or from staff. In 2B, it says, to return to the board in August, September 2012 with a possible renewal option. I would think it would just say with a renewal option. If we're referencing the closure date as December 31st, we would need to be hearing about what the renewal option would be for 13. So
What if we run into real problems in the meeting process?
I think we had that in there.
First of all, that would be 3A and 3B,
right.
I believe.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. And Pat could respond, right, but I believe we had that in there because every August and September, Human Resources comes in with the rates for health care for the next year. And so it's quite possible the rates could change, and it may be a possible renewal. I mean, the board is still paying 75% of the cost, so we left it as a possible renewal.
And then the comment to paragraph three regarding terminate the plan, the comment that it should be more specific.
Just retiree health plan.
Terminate
the retiree health plan.
Instead of plan.
So everyone's okay with that. We would add terminate the retiree health plan to paragraph three, which reflects what we said in paragraph two also.
Right. With the period at the end of
three. That was in three. The first line of three. And then I think the motion clarified a question that I had from one of our retirees, and that is that through March 31st, the retirees would continue to pay the 922 unsubsidized, and shouldn't that be through February 29th instead?
At what we were looking at, and again, I'm answering instead of Pat, so please jump in, but I believe we were looking at, because we have to do meet and confer with all of our bargaining units, that we wanted to give it a little more time. So it would be 922 through, is that right?
Well, but I thought that we had clarified earlier that the meet and confer process didn't present any impediment to going forward with one of these options now, pending the meet and confer process, County Council.
No, I think I guess maybe that wasn't clear. I thought everybody was in agreement that it was subject to a successful meet and confer process, and then it would be implemented. So with the 90-day period out there, that's why we picked the March 31st date.
We also need time to change plan rates. I mean, we need to work with our health plan administrator right. to get the plan in order to start April 1st. But also, it was about subject to meet and confer, a successful meet and confer process, and we need that time as well. And really, we're talking 2 months because it's January 24th already.
So,
okay. Supervisor Pinches.
What would be the process then if we have, we're kind of assuming here that we're going to have a successful meet and confer. What if, as Richard, I think, was the one that said, what if somebody jumps up and down and says?
Well, if there's a problem with the meet and confer process and there are, you know, issues that are being raised, then it'll be back on the board's agenda and you'll have to revisit this before then.
Mr. Shoemaker.
And the old plan will be in effect anyway, right?
9/22, yeah.
Yeah.
Through March is what we're saying, yeah.
Oh, simply through March.
And then if you needed more time and we come back in March and we can extend it further if we need to.
Could there be an accommodation in this, if successful, that, I don't want to put this, if we use that, we have a monthly cost that got you to $219,000 under this scenario total cost. Retirees will pay $259 a month more for 3 months than if we could implement this today. It all kind of shakes out as the same money. Could they, it sounds funny, get a rebate when we get it affected of that difference between the 922 and the 5 or the 663 we'll be paying while we wait to go through the meet and confer process?
This isn't complicated enough.
I'm happy to look at that issue. You know, that was sort of raised through discussions, and my initial reaction was no. I'm happy to look at that issue. I can't guarantee it. The board wants to move forward today with that kind of out there, that would be your choice.
Okay, I would ask that you would consider it. It's $259. That is a big chunk of money to a lot of folks. Mm-hmm.
But there's no guarantee.
There's no guarantee, and it comes up to like 780 over the period.
So is that acceptable to the board that staff will look at that issue?
Let's stick to the motion.
Thank you.
Pardon? Mm-hmm. Let's stick to the motion.
Stick to the motion. And one other clarification I'd like to request. I have heard comments from some of our retirees that they would like to see a continuation of the retiree work group as issues come up in the future going forward, because I think we all agree that this has been a much better process and the board is much more fully informed for having had the benefit of the retiree work group. And a lot of you I know have worked very hard on that. But so I at least would hope that there'd be consideration for keeping that process alive when we need to consider anything that is going to be a change from this, including this issue of can there be a rebate of some kind? What happens through the meet and confer process? So is there any concern from staff on continuing with that process?
I would ask our HR director to answer that.
Well, I think it depends on what situation we're in at any given time and whether we would need to meet or not. One of the things that we discussed, which Sue Goodrick has done before, is gone to the AMCRE quarterly meetings and given an update. And in terms of managing our resources, I would prefer that. And then if a need came, then we could reconvene the work group. That would be my recommendation.
Okay, well, let's make sure we keep the lines of communication mm-hmm. open, however we do it. So is there further discussion of the motion, Supervisor Hamburg?
Yeah, I just want to make sure I'm clear. If a retiree dropped out of the plan in September and then they're not coming back in for longer than a six-month period, does that create a problem because they've been uninsured for longer than the six-month allowance?
Do you want to do it? We do. Yeah. Well, it could. Yeah. Yes, it could. And that's why it's the board policy decision. I mean, normally the opt-in policy is you must have health insurance for 6 months prior to opting in. What we're suggesting is that you waive that basically and allow people who dropped out in September and on to re-enroll in April, provided everything works, and mm-hmm. that we have lower plan rates in April for the retirees.
Okay. But this motion would take care of that
yes.
situation?
Yes.
Yeah, 3A.
And they would okay. essentially have to re-enroll in April if they wanted to do so.
Right. We would be contacting them with letters giving them that opportunity.
Right. So okay. they will all be contacted. Good. Other Supervisor Pinches.
I just want to take an opportunity before we're done with this issue to thank everybody, our staff and consultant in the working group for been a long road to get here. But I want to thank you for the time and effort, especially the working group. You know, staff gets paid, but the working group don't. So I appreciate that.
On that note, we will vote by the button.
Did you want to make comments?
Oh, excuse
me.
It's
too late.
Public comment? We've done that already. We have changed the motion. Oh, and we do have a comment from our consultant. I apologize.
He's just going to tell us bad news.
Supervisor Pinches is correct. I mentioned him at the break, and I apologize. You know, I've only been a consultant here in the county for less than a year. I'm not up to speed on all the way you guys do everything.
Turn on your mic. They can't hear you back.
I thought it was on. Sorry. Okay. But I mentioned to Supervisor Pinches at the break, I represent a significant number of public agencies. My company represents 950 in the state of California. And while I don't expect what I'm about to tell you to change your opinions, you are the only public agency that I work with that is looking to blend retiree and active. Everyone else is looking to separate. I thought you should know that. And now I'm hoping the sheriffs are going to help me get out of the room safely.
I think everyone will be pleased with the outcome of the vote, and
they'll let you out of the room.
And thank you for your assistance in the process. So with that, we will vote by the button. Yeah.
Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you all, and we do still have quite a bit of business to conduct as a board, so unless you're here for another item and you have a conversation, if that could go outside, and we'll continue with our board business.
Thank you, Supervisor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, we will now... We will take up the CEO's report, and I think in deference to the hour, we could kind of have maybe just the highlights.
Okay. Thank you, Chair McCowan. My CEO report, just the highlights. Under Executive Office, the Assessment Appeals Board, I think it would be good for the board to know that we have noticed the vacancies. They've been in all the local newspapers and online. We have not received any applications. So we could continue to notice for this. But again, we have not received any applications. So,
Supervisor Pinches has a question.
You know, I have a question of this, and maybe this should be agenda item, but I was under the impression that when we formed this Assessment Appeals Board, that it was pretty much open to the public. But when I read the app, the notice in the newspaper, it's pretty restrictive.
I think the notice says the requirements that are set forth in the ordinance. That's by statute. The statute requires specific.
But it said in the notice that you had to be an attorney or a real estate broker. It's pretty. I guess my point is, I'm not so sure if it was going to be so restrictive if I would have supported it.
Well, let's get the answer.
Statute requires certain qualifications, but it does allow for the board to waive some of those qualifications if somebody has to do. And I thought that's what takes it right out.
No, it says nothing in there that about some of those conditions could be waived.
Well, we may need to re-advertise because the ordinance that we passed did provide that a person with the appropriate knowledge in our judgment could serve.
But the notice in the papers doesn't reflect that.
We need to review that.
We'll work with county council and see if we could change the notice before we put it back out.
So please continue.
Okay, under budget, just that mid-year we'll be coming in with our mid-year report with our unanticipated increased expenses.
Keep smiling, Carmel.
I am. Regarding the state budget, I think you can see what's there. And just the moves, the Ukiah relocation, planning and building and environmental health has occurred, and they are open for full services. Fort Bragg relocation is finished as well. Staff have moved out of the Affinito building, and they're in the Avila Center. I think we probably have talked about redevelopment over the last day or so, and I think that's pretty much the highlights. February 13th, we have a perinatal substance abuse presentation. The 14th is mid-year, and then you'll also be hearing about AB 109 and also about child welfare services realignment. And then the attachment that you have is just a real brief summary of the initiative that the governor plans on putting on the ballot in November. And that's it.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions to the executive officer's report? Supervisor Brown.
Thank you, Chair McCowan. The room is kind of cleared out, but I just wanted to tell the CEO, Carmel Angelo, how much we do appreciate her and the work she does, the recommendations she makes. Even though we don't always follow them. But thank you for your hard work. We appreciate it.
Thank you. So with that, we will go to item number 6B, introduction and waive reading of ordinance amending section 3.04.071 of the Mendocino County Code regarding compensation for elected county supervisors. This is an item that has been brought forward by Supervisor Brown and myself, and Supervisor Brown will introduce the item.
Thank you, Chair McCowan, and it's mostly there in the summary of request. Previously, I brought forth the item, and it was not on an agenda summary in a previous year. There was not support at that time. I hope we can gain support this time, and it is on a formal summary. And this is to request the introduction, waive the reading of the ordinance, but it is to take a voluntary reduction, and I'm going to read right on here. Does not affect a voluntary deduction, which most all of us have taken, does not reflect retirement and therefore does not equal a 10% savings for the county. The 10% reduction in compensation for the countywide elected offices. And the compensation has also been reduced, a minimum of 10% for all the various county bargaining groups. And these are permanent, an ongoing permanent basis. I believe that being the leaders that we are, that we also need to consider this. There's no one serving at this time on the board that will be affected because it will only be for the new terms of office starting in January 2013. Those that were elected with the former salary can keep that salary. There will be three individuals that will be sworn in 2013, and they will be, if this board agrees, will be at the lower salary rate. I hope you'll join me. Again, these are difficult times. We just made a difficult decision here today, but I think it's really important as county supervisors that we lead with leadership, and I really encourage your support of the recommendation that Supervisor McCowan and myself are making.
And before we get to discussion of the item, are there any questions for clarification? So we will take public item. As you can see, this item has drawn a room full of people wishing to address us.
Come on up, JR. Come on up.
You're going to use half of your 3 minutes just getting up here. Now, we'll wait for you.
You know, these chairs in the front are just as comfortable with you.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, Board of Supervisors, staff, my name is J.R. Rose. As you know, I work for Senior Rights. But I also am a retiree, and I also understand that if you make this permanent, then it will affect your wages, and it also will affect your health and welfare and your retirement. But this is the same thing that you've asked the staff that is working for Mendocino County, the people that's out there in what we call the trenches, to do to keep this county afloat. And I tell you what, it may sound crazy to you, but this will mean a great deal to the public. This will set up a precedent that says, hey, our county board of supervisors understand what we're going through. And I'll tell you what, $900 and something a month for insurance, I couldn't afford it. And if I had a wife, that was $1,800, and there was no way in heck I could ever afford that. I mean, so what you're doing is you're going to take a little bite of the bullet yourself. And if you take this bite of the bullet, I think especially you that are running for re-elections might help you a little bit. And if you don't, it might hurt you a little bit. And that's just a prediction. You can do what you want to with it. I hope you see in your wisdom that you do this and you take care of this, because, like I said, you asked them to take a cut. They took the cut. You gave them the cut. Now, I think Supervisor Brown is right. I think now's the time for you to stand up and be counted. And now's the time to let the county know what you're doing. And as you say, I'm the only one here. But of course, I've been the only one here a lot of times in the last 7 years. And sometimes I think you guys wish I'd go away. Well, one of these days I will. I'll go away. Because I'm not doing a show until April. And that's when the election starts. And when the election starts, hey, look out, I won't be here. So catch you there. Thank you.
Did we have a question?
Not a question, just
okay,
a comment.
Okay, so thank you, Mr. Rose. So it is back for board discussion now.
My comment is, one announced candidate did come up to me earlier today, and he indicated he wouldn't be here this afternoon when we got to this item. He had other commitments, but he did voice his support of this agenda item.
Did he wish to be named?
And yes. Well, he didn't say to be named, okay. But I will. And that was Dan Jurdy.
Mm-hmm. Other comments to the item? Supervisor Smith?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would like to address the motion in this manner.
Is there a second on the motion?
We don't have it.
It's not a motion. It's discussion of the item, I should say. Okay. I misspoke. I'd like to pass out this sheet, and it is exactly on point to the item. One for the clerk. I think this is timely, and I appreciate it being brought forward, because this is the time that this item should be discussed. We discussed it similarly for the other elected officials 2 years ago. I do think, though, that the specifics on the motion are premature, and I'll go into that a little bit in detail. I believe that we did need to look at elected officials' salaries collectively. We did that with the other electeds. We made a rather arbitrary step in just picking a point in time to roll back those salaries. And the reason we did that was that over time, they had collectively received either 5 or 6 salary raises, meaning that the salaries were on an upward slope because they were tied to the department head bargaining units, I believe. Not so with the Board of Supervisors. So in effect, setting our salary or keeping our salary at the $68,000 would be in sync with the time frame that we rolled the other elected supervisor's salary, or other elected officials' salaries back. That being because the Board of Supervisors' salary was essentially flat during the entire time that those salary raises were given to the department head bargaining units. And some of them were really substantial. I think it got up to maybe a 19, maybe less. There was quite an extensive span of the increases to those elected officials. The chart that I just passed out, and this is where I think we should go with this issue, and again, I think it's timely that we discuss it. I believe, as the CAC stated in their report to us a number of years ago, that they felt that the Board of Supervisors' salary should be addressed as the other elected official's salary is addressed. So you could say that, and retrospectively, that we did do that by setting it at 68, because it would have been a point in time, and if we stuck to that, then that would be taking it at a similar juncture, and I think that you could define it that way. But I think it's better to look forward and not backwards. So the proposal that I would like to make is that elected official salaries are very much driven by the geographical area. And so this chart was prepared by the HR director in January of 2011. It points to Humboldt County, Lake County, Sonoma County, and Mendocino. It takes the average of those salaries and then it shows the range. Clearly this is not up to date. I just am using it as a reference point. It's now a year old. I think that we ought to do this on an analytical basis and a data-driven basis. So I appreciate the comments about others running for election, but I think in who's running and what their opinions are, but I think our job should be to eliminate really that from the discussion. I don't think that we set the other elected official salaries that way, and the fact that we are the Board of Supervisors and conduct meetings, we should still treat our salary in the same way. So what I propose that we do is that we would update this table, and then we would really take the politics out of it as much as possible, because then what we would do is get accurate current data, and then we would look at the average and we would say that the Board of Supervisors' salary was so much out of market. And we would keep it out of market to the same degree that the assessor, auditor, DA, sheriff. So to the specifics of what's being proposed, looking at section 3.04071, I do not agree that we should delete section B. I believe section B should be changed. Section B reads, at the first regularly scheduled meeting in April of every odd year. Actually, it should be either, I believe, January, February of every even-numbered year, because it gives then the board the chance to reflect on salaries in a timely manner, which is what we had to do when we brought it forward for the other elected officials. We took that action, although it was not a timed or regular review. I believe it was Supervisor McCown and myself that brought that to the board. I don't believe we should delete that. I believe we ought to leave it in. It's every other even numbered year, and then we would have a chance to adjust this table. So my proposal would be that in order to treat the Board of Supervisors' salary the same as the other elected officials, that what we would do is come up with the current numbers, and then we would decide what percent, and this would be the only deliberative piece that we would really go through. And once we did it, we would do it once and for all, and then I believe, because it is data-driven, that future boards would respect it, and the only thing we would be talking about every 2 years are what minor adjustments would be made. So what we would do is we would decide what percent out of market we would be for each category. In other words, you'd only compare assessors to assessors, auditors to auditors, supervisors to supervisors. Then you would come up with a table and we would have a discussion. Should we be 20% out of market? Should we be 30% out of market? What is the fair and best number for the Mendocino County elected officials to be at? I think that would be a desirable path. I think it's us stepping up to the responsibility, taking politics out of it, taking posturing out of it, and really coming up with an equitable process. And there might be some winners and losers in the short run, but here's one example that I don't think is addressed here. For instance, the DA salary is artificially suppressed. And the reason it is because a previous DA didn't take salary increases for a number of years. That was never adjusted when we did the salary adjustments 2 years ago. So you can see that the DA's salary is 19% out. That's just one example. The other thing that I think is good in doing averaging like this and taking four counties is that if there's any particular outlier where perhaps one salary level seems high in one particular arena, that is averaged out when you take four counties and you average it. I think it's a straightforward method. It takes a lot of the politics out of the situation. It minimizes that. You never take it all out. But my preferred way of going forward, which this proposal here today does not do, which is really addressing the whole issue head on, and that we would be doing every other year updates to the table. And I certainly would consider a salary either higher than what's listed here or lower than what's listed here, depending on where we, the data we got and where we decided to go with all the elected official salaries. And I think overall, over time, we would have a much more equitable salary schedule. There would be a lot of parity between all the divisions, and then regionally we could define and explain how we're doing it. So that would be my proposal.
Thank you. Our Supervisor Brown.
Thank you, Chair McCowan, and I truly appreciate what you brought forward, Supervisor Smith, for us to look at. My only complaint would be I do not think you can compare this county to Sonoma County. Much different county, much wealthier, more populated, has a lot more going on. But I just, you know, for Sonoma to be in there for me, and comparatively, we just can't afford to pay what they pay.
And I totally concur, Supervisor. That's why I said we'd be talking about something that might be 30% lower than the average of all four counties. So the averaging accounts for that. I know we are not compared to Sonoma, but these are the three counties we partner with. They're our next door neighbors. It's the transportation conduits, the economies. We sit on commissions, boards with these other county supervisors. We all know them personally. Sure, you could take it out because it's high, but it sort of defeats the regional discussion. Sonoma County's numbers are suppressed in that they are merged with three other counties. That's why I propose that we would reduce it far below what even the average is. So in no way do I want this to be misconstrued that I'm saying the salary here should be anything comparable to Sonoma County. This is just a regional approach. The data, again, is a year old. I'm just trying to bring forward something. Instead of just trying to throw a current solution to an issue that people perceive to be there, I think that taking this head on, making sure we review it every 2 years, is really doing our job. It's not going to affect me personally. I'm just bringing this forward because I think it's the right thing to do. And once you get this on track, I think it's a good plan. Sonoma County does their supervisor salary based on a connection and a nexus to Superior Court judges' salaries. We consider that. We didn't do that. Humboldt County supervisors, they receive different amounts. I don't think that is a problem either. They work very well together. I've also talked with Sonoma County supervisors. They are receiving various amounts of salary. So I think the sameness sometimes gets stressed a little too much, but for different reasons, our neighbors surrounding us have folks operating with different numbers. That could happen as you went through a process like this every 2 years. You might come up with seated supervisors that made a little bit different salaries depending on when they were seated on the board. I think it's perfectly explainable. This is logical. It's data driven. And I just think it's the responsible way to go. And then the discussion we have is, should we keep the salaries 30% less? Should we have it be 20? Should it be 25? Then that's the only discussion. And then it's fair to every one of the elected categories that we have. And I really think that would take us steps beyond where we are today.
Thank you, Supervisor Hamburg.
Yeah, my thinking about this is quite a bit simpler, I think, than Supervisor Smith's. For one thing, I feel like we just talked about this, but I guess it was back last April.
January.
Last January?
Yeah.
So it was January.
A year ago.
It sure came up fast, I'll tell you. Because, you know, I remember the arguments at that time was that we didn't want this to be a job for only independently wealthy people. We didn't want this to be a job that people did part-time because they couldn't afford, you know, to live on the, you know, the salary and, you know, perhaps even have a family. You know, and I think even at the, you know, at the 68,000 level, that's somewhat of a challenge. The other thing, though, that concerns me about trying to knock the salary down further is that currently we're paid between, if you look on our McLima chart that was in our packets, we're paid between an administrative services manager one and a right. substance abuse program and services manager.
Management.
Oh, I'm sorry. On the management tables. So currently we're paid, you know, between an admin services manager and a substance abuse program manager. And if we go down another 7,000, then we'll be paid between a staff services manager one and the assistant registrar of voters. And, you know, no matter how you slice it, to some degree, your worth to the organization is related to your pay scale. And I'm not saying that our salaries should be, you know, up the levels of some of these comparatively high paid elected officials. But I think if we're paid like middle managers, that's sort of where we're putting our value. You know, that we have the value to the organization of, or, you know, put in another department of a sergeant, right around the salary of a sergeant. How many sergeants do we have? You know, I don't know. Huh? So we're about there with the 13 or so sergeants. And, you know, it just, I don't think we are middle management, even though we get paid like middle management. I mean, I think we're in charge of a, you know, a large operation here. I know that everybody on this board puts in a tremendous amount of hours, you know, and I know we've just imposed this 10% around the county, but we are somewhat different than all the other positions in the county. The Board of Supervisors has, you know, I think we're one of those types of employees that don't, when we leave the office, we don't really leave the job. It's the kind of thing that, you know, at least for me, and I'm sure for the rest of you, it's something you pretty much on your mind all the time.
Supervisor, who leaves the office?
And if you don't leave the office. But anyway, that, you know, those are my misgivings. One is that I feel like we just dealt with this, and here we are dealing with it again. And it's supposed to be every 2 years, and, you know, now we've pushed it up a year. And maybe that's because of what we just went through with SEIU and the other bargaining units. But the other thing is that, you know, I think our pay level already is, you know, is at about where it ought to be. And, you know, I take a 10% voluntary. I plan to continue to take a 10% voluntary. I also don't take a retirement, you know, so that saves a lot of money for the Board of Supervisors budget. And I just think that, you know, it speaks to what our value is to the organization. And I think it's low enough.
I see it quite a bit simpler even than that, and it's not that I disagree with anything that I've heard. I appreciate the information brought forward by Supervisor Smith, but we have gone through a long, difficult process where we have reduced the compensation of every single employee of every single bargaining unit that we have, and we have reduced their compensation a minimum of 10%, and we have reduced it for the lowest paid employees that we have, no matter how far out of market they may have been. As we went through that process, we successively heard the employee organizations, their representatives, their members come forward and tell us how far out of market they were. How much they had already given on a voluntary basis. And it's not that we didn't hear it, but we were mindful of the county budget situation, the need to balance the budget, the need to try and restore financial solvency to the county. We still have serious long-term financial issues. And we made what I think was a difficult decision for all of us to impose these cuts on our employees, despite all of the heartfelt comments of the personal impacts to them and the hardship. We have reduced everybody's compensation a minimum of 10%. And the only problem I have with this item is that we didn't do it 3 years ago. We should have been out front. We should have shown leadership. We should have been the first to take the cut. So all the arguments are valid. They were valid when the employees gave voice to them. We're not comparing. We didn't compare them to Humboldt County or Sonoma County or anyone else. We didn't do market studies. We didn't do percentages. We cut everybody's pay. And there is no other right move than to cut our pay. So that's my position. Supervisor Hamburg?
Well, I would maintain that, in my own case, I already have taken the 10%. And as I've said, I intend to continue to take the 10%. But we can't do that with a bargaining unit. We can't tell a CIU, how many of you will voluntarily take a 10% cut? But we're the only people in the county who have to go before the voters every 4 years. And they, judge us on how we do a number of things, including, on an issue like this. So, I feel like, taking a 10% pay cut, which I do voluntarily and will continue to do, is the right thing from my point
Can't
of
hear
view.
You.
That's the right thing from my point of view as a supervisor.
Supervisor Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. But to the point of elected official salaries, and I do think that's where the nexus should be, the very things that we adjusted, and Supervisor, I work with you on it, in terms of lowering the other elected official salaries when we did that 2 years ago, it was absolutely tied to market surveys. That's what it was based on, because that's how they got the 5 to 6 raises. They were completely compared to their peers. They were out of market. They received 5 to 6 salary increases in, I think, a 2 to 2.5 year period in most instances. I'm not sure in all, but in most. So they, in other words, to put our salary in sync with other elected officials is, I think, the most appropriate nexus. All I'm trying to do is level the playing field. So if we want the Board of Supervisors' salaries to be 20% out of market, and I think that this is a fair market to consider, and 20, 25, I don't know what the right number is. But then all the other elected officials should be in the same ballgame. And sure, there's going to be blips in the road, but it's us being leaders. We're talking about leadership. That's the decision we should make, and in 2 to 4 years, people won't even really remember that we finally stood up and did it based on something that was data-driven and analytical, not that one group was tied to a bargaining unit, but the other wasn't, and then, well, what happened, and why did their salary go up, and the other groups didn't? The very adjustment that we made to the other elected official's salary was because of market-driven analysis that drove their salaries so high. And if you rolled ours back, in time, ours would have stayed at the current $68,000 level at the point in time we rolled those back. We've already had that discussion, I think, here more than once. But if you look at the January 2011 data, the Board of Supervisors' salary is out 25%, more than any of the other elected officials in the same categorical analysis. So I'm just asking for it to be, for there to be parity. I think it's the right thing to do going forward. I think that's where we should be. And I'm willing to discuss having it be lower or higher. I just think we need to level the playing field, bring it all back, and just take an action. And I'm willing, I don't have a number. I don't have a set place where I think any of these salaries should be. This is an opportunity to have the DA salary not be an outlier, or any of the others that for whatever reason are higher or lower. We get them all into something that is very explainable to the public, and we put it almost on an automatic pipe.
Supervisor Pinches.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There's been a lot of discussion, a lot of conversation with me over the last few years, all the way going back to 5 years ago when I supported a 47% increase in the Board of Supervisors salary. Things have changed a lot. But for 80-90% of the people that make the comments to me about board of salary, their comment, at least 80% of the time, is I wouldn't have that job for anything. And that's been pretty consistent. I agree with Supervisor Smith trying to come up with something that'll make it an ongoing problem or solve an ongoing problem for a year, because every board really don't really want to talk about compensation of the salary. And I agree with Supervisor Hamburg that, you know, the salary is probably fairly right. But, you know, we're in difficult times, and we've just, like Supervisor McCown said, you know, we probably should have been the leader instead of the tail end of this. You know, these are unprecedented times, and I think it's only fair, and not looking any further to the public, or certainly not looking towards what the compensation is going to be for future Board of Supervisors, but really looking to the issue of how do we treat our existing county employees? Kind of like this little while ago, how do we treat our retirees? And the only thing that I see that makes sense is that we acknowledge, you know, we've asked everybody and they've taken the 10%. Some of it we had to even impose. But so I support this recommendation, and I appreciate the supervisors for bringing it forward. And, you know, there's a whole reason to support stabilization or making a long-term set of a salary set, or to even, there's justification for maybe can the board salary more. But, you know, one of the things I'd like to say about this chart, you know, if you look at these three counties we're pairing them to, none of them three counties basically carry any debt, where the Mendocino County carries a huge amount of debt, and that has to be considered. When you're carrying a huge amount of debt, it has to be considered in every financial decision you make. And although the CEO would probably disagree with me today, but anyways, I support the recommendation. And I'll make that motion.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second on the floor. Supervisor Hamburg, comment to the motion?
No. No, I can, you know, I can count.
Oh. Supervisor Brown, did you have a comment?
Well, I did. I wasn't sure how Supervisor Pinches was feeling, but my comment was going to be perhaps add back in that every odd year we do look at it, just like we do with employees' contracts, with the MOUs. There are, you know, final dates where you go back and rediscuss compensation for the work performed and the times that, you know, we're in. So I don't know if we want to go there, but I can count too.
Well, and I'd offer a comment to that. The agreements that we have made with our employees provide for a minimum of a 10% cut on an ongoing permanent basis, and that'll be until there's a successor agreement that changes that. But there's no automatic provision in there to review it, increase it, and in fact, the Board of Supervisors, one thing that's different, we're the only group that does set our own pay. So we really can't complain that, gosh, we haven't had a raise since July of 2007, because that was the action of the board. But at that time, the board did give themselves a 40-some percent increase, which was maybe a catch-up. And I don't maintain that we're overpaid, but we didn't look at any of those factors with the other groups. And when we reduced the other countywide elected officials, when they got the raises, there may have been, and I think there was, an analysis of where they stood in relation to the market. Mm-hmm. When we reduced them, We didn't consider that. We simply reduced them 10% across the board. And again, I think it's overdue for us to take the same action. If at any point in the future we think it's appropriate to review our compensation, we can do that. So we do have a motion on the floor. We've tripled our public attendance since we first asked for public comment. I will ask if anyone present who hasn't spoken would like to address the board on this issue. Seeing no one come forward, any further comment to the motion? We will vote by the button.
Motion passes with Supervisors Smith and Hamburg dissenting.
Thank you. Does anyone need a break? No, okay.
Which one have we got?
We have two off-agenda items, and we have supervisor reports, I believe. The first off-agenda item deals with the proposal that was going to the State Public Works Board, I believe, and Supervisor Smith. Would...
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair.
And then could we have that other one?
Yes. First, I'll go to County Council for the urgency findings. This is a letter to the Public Works Board. The reason for the urgency finding would be that we just found out about this, over the weekend, I believe I found out about it. And the Public Works Board is scheduled to meet February 1st, and that would be prior to our next meeting. Okay, then, Mr. Chair, I would move the urgency request for this item.
I'll second.
So we have a motion by Supervisor Smith, seconded by Supervisor Pinches. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
The item is now before us. Is there a motion?
So just to introduce the item, it's a letter of the Public Works Board. I think it's pretty self-explanatory. Supervisor Hamburg's been involved with various park groups. I've been involved with them as well, some we've done concurrently. Working with the state parks representative and the advocates locally, there's a strong concern that the present bundling, where the state would like to have management be put out in an RFP format for 11 parks, would severely disadvantage our local entities that have worked very rigorously on this for weeks, if not months, to come up with management plans for a number of the parks. They would be seriously disadvantaged in the current proposal that Public Works Board is about ready to roll out. And so hence, you have a draft letter that would be signed by the chair to express our concern on that. And then I'd go to Supervisor Hamburg to add any additional comments.
No, I just, you know, I just echo what Supervisor Smith said. I want to just mention Kathy Bailey, who has been leading the Save Hendy Woods effort in Anderson Valley, along with the Anderson Valley Chamber of Commerce and the Community Services District, so, and the MAPA Board. So there's a lot of efforts that are being made to try to keep Mendocino County parks open. And, you know, I thank Supervisor Smith for actually catching this in the Press Democrat over the weekend and alerting Kathy, and, you know, we got this letter together, and I just really am glad that the board is going to support these efforts.
And I'd like to mention Team Standish as well. That's what they're calling themselves. I've met with them in Leggett. Very passionate about keeping local control and operation of that very important park with, I think, 163 campsites. It's approximately 1,000 acres, and they very much want to have the option to put forward a proposal. So with those comments, I'd like to make the recommended action.
Second.
Motion by Supervisor Smith, second by Supervisor Brown to send the letter as requested. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. We have another off-agenda item that I hope has been distributed to everybody. It would be a consideration of a letter to Assemblymember Wesley Chesbro in support of a request by the North Coast Railroad Authority to introduce legislation appropriating funds from the public transportation account to provide support for railroad operations. There is an urgency in that I believe bills must be in to the appropriate office by the end of this month, And so therefore, the support letter encouraging him to introduce legislation directed to Assemblymember Chesbro would be timely. And council, can the findings be made on that basis? Is there a motion to make the necessary findings?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Supervisor Smith, second by Brown. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
So the item's now before us. I did bring it forward. The public transportation account receives over $600 million annually, and those funds are earmarked for urban transit and also for intercity rail. The NCRA, although it's authorized by the state, established by the state to maintain the rail corridor, does not receive any ongoing appropriation for the ongoing maintenance of the line. And it's been very challenging for NCRA, particularly with the line shut down for a decade, to properly maintain the line. The agenda summary goes into some detail with the fire hazards, illegal hazardous dump sites, illegal camping and trespassing, vandalism, deterioration of railroad infrastructure, including bridges, culverts, highway crossings, and the rail bed itself. So it's a real challenge to try and maintain that and keep the rail corridor from deteriorating further. So again, the request is to encourage Assemblymember Chesbro to introduce legislation to provide an ongoing appropriation for maintenance and emergency issues that would occur on the rail corridor. Comments from the board? Supervisor Pinches.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I have a real problem with this. First of all, I called our, board members know, I'm a county representative for the MTA, Mendocino Transit Authority, and I called our executive director, and he knew nothing of this bill. And this directly affects MTA because Mendocino Transit Authority is the only public transit agency in Mendocino County, and this puts Mendocino County MTA in direct competition with this funding. And I just, you know, this money, if it was acquired, wouldn't even be used in Mendocino County anyway. And
well,
I'd like to.
No, that's not fair to assume.
Well, I'd like to direct. This is a report back in 2004 to the California Transportation Commission. And I'm just going to read some excerpts from it here. It talks about the money. This is back in, keep in mind, 2004, how these same monies were. And makes funding available for the required EIS work north of Willits. And then it goes on here, it says, here this is on page 3, it says, Mendocino Superior Court ordered the NCRA in 1999 to clean up, among other things, 9 rail yards from Hoppin Eureka, a $696,000 task order funded by the TCRP, this is this type of money, was used by NCRA in August 2002 to begin the compliance effort. The majority of the site characterization work, cleanup at plans and specifications, and environmental clearances have been cleaned under the watchful eye of the Department of Fish and Game. Those sites that they're talking about here, about cleaning, getting the money for the cleanup, have never been cleaned up. And then I'd like to refer you back to the same Senate bill sponsored by Chesbro back in 2005. It talks about the money in the public transportation account going, and this was the same amount of money that was directed to the NCRA in for the same work, and it was never, you know, it was never directed to get any of the work done. And there's an excerpt in here I'd like to read, but this is available. I've got a whole stack of records from the long record of what's happened with the NCRA. And I don't know, there's just been a, you know, if you remember, there was about 4 years of all the documents in the CRA couldn't come up with. They were had an audit, to doing an audit, and they couldn't come up with anything, if you remember that. But I got a whole record of the NCRA's past history and where the money went for. See, this is where the NCRA put some money, and $500,000 went to the administration in CRA. Most of the money went for the administration through the years. And this is a bill back in 2005 that was many millions of dollars. This bill allocates $5.5 million to the grant made to the North Coast Rail Authority under the Transportation Congestion Relief Act to fund the NCR's environmental remediation cleanup obligation and payment towards the NCR's rental at the annual administrative expenses. And it talks about how the all what they're supposed to do. And I have seen nothing basically done in Mendocino County. But really gripes me is the CCTC awarded back in 2004 for the cleanup of those sites. And now the state's still applying, or NCRSA still applying for money to do those sites. Where'd the millions go that they got to clean up those sites in the first place?
I'm not as qualified to respond to that as the NCRA staff. However, it is my understanding that the surface level cleanup was accomplished. There was not a complete cleanup. And with regard to the Ukiah Depot site, the city of Ukiah, through its redevelopment agency, is currently in the process of completing the environmental cleanup of that site. And then when and if the depot parcel sells, NCRA will reimburse the city of Ukiah for the cleanup costs. So NCRA is going to pay for the completion of the cleanup costs at Ukiah. With regard to the bill that you mentioned for the $5.5 million, there were at least two bills of that along those lines that were then vetoed, so they didn't ultimately become law. We'd have to go back and check to see if that was one of them, but I suspect that it was. And I do take it you're against the recommended action, and so before we go further, I want to clarify whether you voted for or against the motion to make the findings to consider it.
To consider?
Well, we had to make findings to take it up as an off-agenda item. I want to make sure we have an accurate record of the vote on that.
No, I didn't say nothing. I didn't vote yes.
So were there any votes against that?
Yes.
Okay, so then it was 4-1
yeah.
on that. Okay, thank you. And so now Supervisor Pinches.
Well, basically, you know, as far as this environmental cleanup, it really gripes me because they've got millions of dollars going way back, and I can show that. And none of the environmental sites in my district have even been touched. The only reason they're working on this one in Ukiah is because they plan on selling the site, so they're doing that. But the environmental work that they received millions of dollars to in Neil River Canyon, so I guess the money got diverted to down south. And that wasn't the intent of the money. The money wasn't intended to fix up the rail. The CTC never awarded the money to fix up the rail down south. The money was awarded to fix up, do the environmental remediation in the sites, and I can name the sites. They're in here of where the sites were. It says right here, Doss Reis Yard, Willis Yard, Hopland Yard, Alder Point Yard, Island Mountain Yard. You know, so that was very specific, what they were given money from the CTC to do. And what my point is, now with this support of this, it's going to put it in direct competition with our Mendocino Transit Authority in this county. And that really concerns me because the operation dollars, these are operation dollars that MTA could get, and now they're going to be competing with the NCRA.
Well, I'm going to make a comment, and then we'll see if anyone from the board has a comment. But you correctly state that the cleanup money was for specific rail yards. It wasn't for the rail corridor. It was for the rail yards. And I do believe that the surface level cleanup was done. Now, they didn't go underground and do the underground cleanup.
They never done nothing.
Well, I disagree with that, okay. and one of us is wrong, and I can't say which with certainty here. But I think we'll, you know, you've got a lot of past history with the issue also, but this is an issue of, you know, the rail line has been opened to freight for the southernmost 62 miles to Windsor, and the NCRA continues to struggle even to do the most basic levels of maintenance, such as to keep the trestles repaired so that somebody doesn't fall through and injure themselves. And without funding, those things can't be maintained. And I disagree that this necessarily puts them in competition with MTA. Any application by MTA will be considered on its own merits, and they've been very successful at receiving funding. And I think that since the funds are specifically provided for inner city rail, that if NCRA has a chance to be able to compete for those funds, we ought to give them the chance. But with that, I think we should hear from the rest of the board. If there's no support for this, we can drop it.
I'm just not very comfortable acting on it. I'm not very comfortable acting on it because, you know, I hear two very different opinions. You know, my own experience with the railroad has been that it just sucks money and sucks money and sucks money, and we never get the service that we're promised. But I am encouraged to see that Lombard to Windsor is now open to freight. That's something positive. But, you know, with two of my colleagues disagreeing on whether this is, you know, something that's going to conflict with another county program, I'm just reluctant to vote on it.
Well, what I would say also, any bill that goes in front of the legislature, and there hasn't even been a bill introduced yet, but I think we all know how carefully they get scrutinized, the number of revisions they go through. So if there's any issue, it's going to be fleshed out, and everyone's going to have an opportunity. I am the representative of this board to the NCRA. The NCRA board, comprised of our representatives from our partner counties and a city representative as well, are fully in support of this, and it's just a request to go forward with an opportunity for the NCRA to have the funding to address the issues we'd all like to see them address. Supervisor Brown?
Well, I've been listening to both my colleagues and Chair McCowan. I gave you my copy, so I didn't even get to read the letter. But I certainly think, I hope it's not competing. I think it's something we need to think about. I hope it's not competing with local funding. But you're absolutely correct in the fact that when a bill gets introduced, if someone will carry it for you, goes through a lot of scrutiny through committees and is really vetted, and others are able to submit comment either for or against any legislative measure, as well as appear and testify. And you are a representative. I guess I would support moving forward, but I do hear what Supervisor Pinches is saying. And I hope that I was going to ask today during Supervisor's report to have the Golden Gate Bridge District again come forward, because they have a lot going on. They have a birthday celebration coming up, and you know, they have Smart Train, and there's numerous things going on with the Golden Gate Bridge District. So I would really love to entertain this. You're the first one, and not to be critical of the former representative to the NCRA, but you're the first representative to actually bring back information to us in full, I guess, is the best way to say. So I do appreciate it, but maybe we can have a more thorough report, because I really lack understanding of all that's going on with its business and its debt. But I'll support the motion, or I'll make the motion.
Well, I don't know if we will have a second, but
we'll
there
see.
Is a motion. Is there a second at this time?
I'd like to make a comment to Supervisor.
Well, first of all, I'm not hearing a second to the motion, so the motion dies for lack of a second. Supervisor Pinches.
I'd like to answer Supervisor Brown. This first paragraph in this letter admits, it says, these funds are earmarked for public transit systems. That's an admission that they're in competition with MTA. I just ask you one question. The MTA has been driven, providing services throughout Mendocino County for a lot of years. In the last 15 years, what services the NCRA provided to Mendocino County?
15 years ago, the trains were running.
Well.
Supervisor Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think at this juncture, it's late. I'd really like to get on to the supervisor's reports. I have quite a bit of material, I know, to present. And probably
I was
others.
Actually going to continue those to the next
well,
meeting.
Well, I'd like to at least talk about a few. I think it would be just wise at this point that you, as our representative, basically just draft your own letter. It seems like there's confusion and people don't have information, and we're not getting a board majority to support it. So I think you would write a very good letter as the board's rep to the NCRA as an individual supervisor and say that you support this and carry forth until we get more information.
With your support, we would have a board majority.
When I loaned you this information, Supervisor McCallum, you had the opportunity to take these damaging pieces of paper out of that file I had, but you didn't do that.
Oh, did you retrieve your file?
Yeah.
Chair McCallum, I was asked a question.
Supervisor Brown.
Talking about MTA, Supervisor Pinches, Potter Valley receives no services.
Yes, they do. Now they do. We're introducing the E-Ride program. It'll be throughout the county.
And that is just call and they take you?
Yeah.
Wow. Are we going to have a presentation on that?
It's in the process to be expanded all over the county.
We did have a presentation on it.
Yeah.
Well, but not to Potter Valley.
But they came and told us what it was about.
Do we have any? We will leave this item where it is. Are there any other items of business other than supervisor reports?
No, all items have been addressed.
Pardon? I didn't think it was.
All items have been addressed.
So we will defer supervisor reports to the next meeting, and we are adjourned.
No, we're not.
Wait.
We have, don't we have 8A? Did we do 8A?
We did.
I just didn't mark it off. Okay.
It was part of the consent calendar.